Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Paulson Stadium in Statesboro, Georgia. Delano Little and I'm Bill Edwards going to bring you today the game between the Georgia Southern Eagles, the two-time defending national champions, going against the Maine Black Bears. And Black Bears, I think, is probably an appropriate term, Delano. Those guys look big and mean.
They were really big. We met them at the airport when they got in, and I don't know, it looked like a herd of cattle coming in.
Well, a herd of cattle, I guess. We don't mean that in a derogatory way.
No, of course not.
Means, yeah. They're just big guys, and they look like they're ready to play. There was a quiet confidence about them, Delano, that you had to respect.
Well, yes, they look pretty good. They're a team that has to come from behind a lot this season. They've come from behind five times, and I don't think anything is going to bother them. If they get behind early, look for them to play tough throughout the whole game.
Right, the come-from-behind attitude is something that Coach Tim Murphy, who is a very impressive young man at only 31 years of age, the youngest coach in Division I or Division I AA in the NCAA, has brought this team down here. Three consecutive winning seasons now for the University of Maine, their first time in the playoffs in 22 years. And what are the odds, Delano, that Dr. Dale Lick leaves here as the president of Georgia Southern College, goes up to Maine, and he said he was going to do something with that program up there, and obviously he's got him in the playoffs against his old team.
I don't know. It's 1,001. It looks like something was set up here. We need to check the NCAA and see if it wasn't kind of arranged for Maine to play Georgia Southern. But it is a special game in that respect. As we mentioned, Coach Murphy is the youngest coach in Division I AA. It's interesting to note that his predecessor had been the youngest coach in the NCAA, and now Coach Murphy took over that position.
Well, it's also the weather here today is not exactly what we expected. We expected overcast skies and about a 50% chance of rain, but we expected temperatures to be in the low 70s. It feels like it's maybe in the mid-60s, and there's a little bit of a breeze blowing. Could be a factor, and probably more for Maine's liking.
Well, Maine has a good passing offense, and it may affect some of their throwing if it does rain here today. Georgia Southern has a good defense, so I'd look for a defensive struggle today.
Okay, well, there you have it. It's going to be some it's going to be a great football game, so stick around. The kickoff is coming up next. We'll see you then. Good afternoon again, everyone, from Paulson Stadium in Statesboro, Georgia. I'm Bill Edwards, along with Delano Little. We have got a great game plan for you today between the University of Maine and Georgia Southern. Delano, you said just before that you expected a defensive struggle. I got a feeling we're going to see some offensive fireworks as well. Mike Buck from Maine is one of the most impressive quarterbacks I've seen. A sophomore, just had an incredible season, something like 211 completions this year, which set a team record. And you see the teams meeting on the middle of the field right now for the coin toss. But I'm expecting an offensive show.
Well, whatever it'll be, I think it'll be a good game for the crowd, and everybody is out. The Georgia Southern fans are excited. The University of Maine has brought a small following, and one of the fans for University of Maine has a cowbell, which is very interesting. So it'll be kind of loud over there on their side of the field.
Might have messed up, met up with some of the folks from Mississippi State or something to get that cowbell. But at any rate, Maine has won the toss, elected to receive, or did Georgia Southern win and elect to defer? I'm not sure which, but at any rate, Maine is going to be receiving the football.
I'm sure if Georgia Southern did win the toss, they usually defer. Coach Russell is stout about doing that, so I'm sure that they did defer.
Team that has come from behind so many times, both of these teams have had their backs against the wall the last 4 weeks, Delano. They had to win all four ball games in order to be here this afternoon, and they did.
Well, University of Maine came in, and they had to play Illinois State, I think it was 2 weeks ago, and they had to come from a deficit of something like 24-3, and they have come from behind in a lot of games. So like I said, don't look for University of Maine to give up if they go down early.
Right, 28 fourth quarter points, as a matter of fact, in that one, and that is just an incredible comeback. So it seems like a wounded bear is a very dangerous animal.
That's true. Georgia Southern, they're no stranger to having to come back as well. They've had to fight adversity over the last 2 years. So I think it should be a good ball game.
One of the most interesting aspects, I guess, of this game is the strange parallels that we've talked about so many times. Both teams coming in here with 8-3 records. Coach Irk Russell has become almost legendary. The program has become almost legendary as the Georgia Southern Eagles take the field, getting ready for the kickoff. And then a young coach coming in here, and the two teams playing each other for the first time in the playoffs. The former president of Georgia Southern, Dale Litt, goes up and has become president of the University of Maine. And both teams coming from behind in fine tradition. So it's going to be an outstanding ball game this afternoon here at Paulson Stadium.
Well, I personally know President Litt. He really is a great person. And I think that Georgia Southern has lost a great president, but the University of Maine has gained a good president. Dale Litt is interesting to note that he will not be here for the game.
That's true. He said he had prior business commitments, and so he could not make it. But his son Ron came down here. Ron, a freshman up there at the University of Maine, has taken on some good responsibilities. The only freshman to make the golf team, so congratulations to him. And welcome everybody from Maine. We're going to try to keep this as down the middle as possible, folks. You have to realize that Delano played on both of the national championship teams from Georgia Southern as Rob Witten kicks it off. And Maine receiver is going to be taking it down there, and that's big, number 17. Done for you. Getting it up to long kickoff return. Going up, how far did he go, Delano?
He got up to the 40-yard line. Coach Russell is not going to be very happy about that. He teaches a good sound punting game and kicking game, and he likes to stop him at the 20-yard line.
Rob Sterling from Silver Spring, Maryland, took that one, a sophomore, and got it almost to midfield. And one of the things that Georgia Southern has worked on this year is the ball sits right on the 40-yard line, main zone, and Mike Buck is going to bring them up. Very impressive quarterback. He's got the guys set in the backfield, including Dan Gordon, who's working back there. Who else has he got back there? Ray Wood, and Mike Buck is going to roll out and fire right away. And hits his receiver right in the hands. Big number 85, that is Tony Lanza. Lanza gets it and is hit hard over there, and a good defensive play by Georgia Southern because he had it right on the mark.
Well, it's really good to have a good hit to start the game off because it makes those receivers a little leery about catching the ball.
That was Nay Young who broke that one up, and Nay is always right around the football as you see the replay there.
I talked with Nay Young before the game, and he said he was fired up, and it showed on that first play.
Buck is going to bring him up. Georgia Southern almost jumped off sides, and there goes another one. He gets back in time, and Buck drops straight back to pass. He's going to fire it in the flats out there to the big fullback. That's big number 45, Ray Wood. Wood, their best blocker as far as that goes. Bart Hughes, number 97, the linebacker, sophomore from Duluth, Georgia, knocks him down, and there is a gain of about a yard or two on the play. It'll be third down and almost 8 yards to go.
Well, that time, Flint Matthews, the outside linebacker, did a wonderful job of forcing the play back inside, and that's what you teach the linebackers. Don't let that team get outside, or they'll get some big yardage.
They bring him up. Jim Fox is also split back there. They run out of a multiple eye. They show multiple sets, and that confuses defenses a lot, too. So backs against the wall again. It is third down and about eight as Buck drops straight back to pass. A big rush being put on him, but missed by Tyrone Hull and complete to Sergio Hebra. And Hebra's got about a 20-yard pickup as he goes down, make it about 22 yards as he goes across the 40 into the 38-yard line of Georgia Southern before Terry Young can bring him down. First down for the University of Maine, their first down of the afternoon. The game just underway, no score.
I think Georgia Southern has to get a defensive pass rush if they're going to stop this great quarterback, Mike Buck, because Georgia Southern does not have a good defense as far as the quarterback setting up and taking a long time to throw the ball.
He brings him up. He's got Ray Wood and Jim Fox set right behind him. And in motion is Heber to the left. Split out wide. Georgia Southern moves a little bit. The give to Fox straight at the middle, and there is nothing there. Big number 97 came in. Let's see, Flint Matthews was the first one in there along with Bart Hughes and knocked him down. I don't think they gained an inch. Here you go. You're going to watch it very coming up here on the replay. Fox gets the call. Fox has had a great season.
I think that was Tyrone Hull.
Tyrone Hull in there on the interception, yeah.
They're the bulk of that defensive line. It's interesting to note that Georgia Southern has lost their starting lineman, James Carter.
Second down, 10. Buck's going to pass. At least he's going to try. He may have to run out of there, and a couple of guys miss him. He's going to pick up a first down and run out of bounds at about the 25-yard line. Pick up of about 13 yards on the play. So all his receivers well covered, and, of course, that's what happens. He's got so many good receivers out there, Delano. As soon as they're covered, he's got plenty of room to run.
That's right. Georgia Southern both times have got a hand on the quarterback, but they haven't been able to bring him down.
First and 10 for the Black Bears. Ball resting just inside the 30-yard line, about the 29 of Georgia Southern. Buck's going to give straight up the middle there to Wood. And again, there's not much going up in the middle.
Georgia Southern is very tough against the run. I believe University of Maine will have to pass to win this ball game today.
Defensive guard Charlie Waller was the guy who got him. You see down from the ground how big those guys are. Pass rush is just something that's going to be, I think, non-existent today.
Bill, I mentioned that Wildman Carter wasn't playing. He has been suspended from the game for disciplinary reasons by Coach Russell. It was a move that he and the staff decided on.
James Wildman Carter, the guy who was probably the best pass rusher that we've got, and as you said, disciplinary reasons, rules are rules, and he broke them. Long pass from Mike Buck into the end zone. Sergio Hebra, he's got it. Touchdown.
Well, there's that great passing attack. I said that University of Maine will have to pass to win this ball game. Georgia Southern has to get some type of pressure on Mike Buck if they intend to stop him.
Hebra right across the middle, and they said that Coach Russell said they were going to put their best Baptist on Hebra today, and it didn't look like the Baptists were quite there in time as Hebra gets it right across the middle, and that is something he's caught 71 balls, I guess, this season now, and the extra point is up and perfect.
This is something that's very rare for the University of Maine. They're usually behind at this point in the game, and now they're ahead 7-0. So we'll see how things develop.
12:03 to go in the first quarter. The score is 7-0 Maine, and we'll be back.
Didn't get any type of pass rush. Well, they did get a pass rush, but you've got to tackle the man to stop him from throwing those touchdown passes like that.
So Maine getting ready to kick it away, and the Eagles will get their first crack at trying to score against the Black Bears, and we'll see how things go. She goes not a very deep kick. It's going down. It's going to be taken by Nay Young at about the 15-yard line. He comes straight up the middle of the field. Big hole there, and Nay has got some good speed. He's up in midfield and just gets tackled as he comes across the 40-yard line of the University of Maine Black Bears. A great run back before Keith James brings him down.
Nay Young had some running room that time. He almost broke that. All he needed was one block.
He needed one more block, but that he did not get. So we're going to see how the Maine Black Bears react to a 40-yard field. Actually, a little less than 40. The ball is just inside. As you see it come back, as Nay takes it on about the 16-yard line, I guess it was, and coming up with that big hole right through the middle there before he's finally brought down. And a little running play there as we come back to live action momentarily. Give goes in the middle. Not much. Scott Nason brings down the runner. Who got the ball that time, Delaney? I was watching the replay.
I think that was Joe Ross. I think that was a run straight up the middle. I think it was part of the option, and he just decided to give it.
And Ross, the big fullback. Freshman quarterback in Raymond Gross. This kid just in high school last year, kind of hard to believe, just playing up the road here about 30 miles. Gross is going to take the pitch, and he's going to pitch it out to Ernest Thompson on the right side. Thompson's got room down to the 20-yard line. Pickup of about 18 yards on the play before Andy Nickerson can bring him down, the outside linebacker.
It looked like that time if Ernest Thompson would have stayed outside, he may have been able to break that one all the way, but I imagine that's easy for me to say sitting up here. Bill.
That's always easy to say, yeah, right. when you're 50 yards away from it, yeah, that's different. Well, just inside the 19-yard line, inside the 20-yard line of the University of Maine Black Bears, and it's kind of hard to figure out that option if you haven't seen it. That always gives the defense a little bit of trouble. Give is going to go straight up the middle, and Scott Nason is going to be there to make the tackle once again. Joe Ross getting the call, and Ross goes inside and picks up maybe, a yard at the most.
He may have got a yard that time. It's interesting. Raymond Gross is getting his signals from Coach Jay Russell, who is the son of Irk Russell, head coach Irk Russell.
So Raymond brings him out. It's going to be second down and about 9, and the give is going to go to Ross up the middle again, and he gets it to the 15-yard line. It'll wind up being about 3rd down and 5 or 6. Mike Danino has made the tackle on that play, the outside linebacker. New York kid.
Georgia Southern running and straight up the middle. They're going to make Maine stop them.
So far, no pass from Georgia Southern. Maine is leading 7-0. We've got 10 minutes to go in the first quarter. 3rd down and about 4. Call it 3rd down and 3 as Gross changes the play at the line of scrimmage. In motion is Frank Johnson, and Raymond's going to keep it himself. He could go all the way. There he is. Touchdown. We're just about to tie this up. Here you go. You're going to watch Gross fake it. Frank Johnson went in motion to the left as the pitch man. They may have played him just a little too much there, and Raymond saw the opening. And here he goes, right into the corner.
Well, that defensive end was in a no-win situation. He had to take the quarterback and the pitch man. He opted for the pitch man, and Raymond Gross did the smart thing, just ran it right on in for the touchdown.
All-American candidate Tim Foley in for the extra point to try to tie this thing up at 9:44 to go in the first quarter. I knew we'd have an offensive battle for you folks, and there it is. It is 7-7. Georgia Southern and Maine are going to start all over again. 9:44 to play in the first quarter, and we'll be back after this. Division 1 AA playoffs. Glad you folks in Maine could join us today, and I just think it's a shame, Delano, that that schools like this and players that are this good don't get the television exposure that they really should. I think if the networks really wanted to do us a favor, they could start putting these guys on programs that need the money, too.
They really should, but the pros have been noticing the talent in the Division 1 AA because a lot of them have been being drafted and going on his free agency.
Rob Whitten kicks it away. It's going to be Sterling taking it at about the 7-yard line. He's up to the 20 and to the 25. Another good run back. Another short field. He comes right across the middle. This thing's going to go to midfield. Delano, I think it's going to be whoever's ahead when the game's over. It's going to win this thing this afternoon. I mean, it's just a matter of going back and forth, and Nae Young finally had to bring him down.
Did I say something about a defensive struggle earlier this game?
I think you did, Delano, but that was on tape. We can erase that. Okay, so inside Georgia Southern territory, and once again the defense is working with a 47-yard field.
Coach Russell's not happy with those run backs. He calls his kickoff team the KKK, and they're not doing too good of a
job.
That's
right. That's the crazy kick covers for those of you in Maine who are listening and not familiar with Coach Russell and his rather unorthodox approach. And the give is going to go to Wood, and Wood cracks down for about 3 yards there before David Hodge can bring him down. Wood gets it to the 40-yard line of the Eagles. Wood is just a big, burly guy who is one of their best blocking, I guess Maine's best blocking back.
Well, most of those guys on Maine's team are big and burly.
Yes, they are. And it's going to be, he picked up, it looks like about 8 yards on the play. It's going to be second and three, make it 7 yards. Ball resting just at the 40-yard line of Georgia Southern. In motion to the left is Fox, and Buck goes straight back to pass, fires across the middle, and again, a nice defensive play. Tony Lanza had it right in his hands, and he was hit from behind. Looked like Flint Matthews over there. Flint is an incredible guy for his size as far as his speed goes. He's always around the football. He's very good at knocking it down, and he's been known to intercept him a time or two.
Well, yes, he has. But, Bill, that time I think that was David Hodge, the outside linebacker.
Aha. Uh-huh.
But right. He was the person, the victim, getting the hand in front of the tight end that time.
Buck's going to bring him up again. Woods right behind him. And Fox behind him. The give is going to go to Fox. Fox cuts off the left side, and there's about 3 or 4 yards there. He's very close to a first down and may have it as he gets down to about the 35-yard line before Tyrone Hull can lasso him there and bring him down, and they're going to have to measure it. No, they're not going to measure it. I saw him wave his hands to look like a call a timeout or something, but wasn't that just to stop the clock to get the chain set? I don't think anybody's going to have to worry about home cooking today from the officials. All these guys are NCAA approved, and they come in here, and they could care less who wins.
I like that term, home cooking.
Yeah, they we've affectionately referred to it that way in the past. As Buck brings him back, and he's going to go straight back to pass after the fake to Fox. He's being run out of the pocket, rolls around, and fires complete over there to big number 96. That's Justin Strelzik. And Strelzik's got him another first down. Almost at the 20-yard line before Oliver Davis can bring him down. Interesting story about Oliver Davis is that he came in and they put him, I think, an outside linebacker or something like that. Delano, he was at another position and they had to find something for him to do. And you can watch him as he gets rushed out of the pocket here looking for somebody to throw to. And he's not known for his scrambling ability, but a great athlete like Mike Buck. And he just fires it right down to Strelzik, and they've got a first down just outside the 20-yard line. Buck again rolling out to his right. Pass firing complete. Looks like a touchdown to me. Or is it? Nope, they say right at the corner. Well, that's about as close as you can get. Dan Gordon was on the receiving end of that one. They have got so many. They got such a great receiver core. Let's call it first and goal from an inch away before Taz Dixon knocked him down. And
Georgia Southern's going to have to get tough right here.
They have had a couple of great goal line stands at this point, sports fans, but I don't believe it's going to be tough to see one today with the size of this main line. Let's just find out. First and goal. Mike Buck's going to sneak it right in and make the score 13-7, University of Maine.
Yeah, I think I made a little mistake when I said that about the defensive struggle. I'll take that back.
Okay. Well, don't be so hard on yourself.
You're Maine mentioning that about...
Gosh, how many plays is that? Six, seven at the most.
Well, it's not that hard when you start your offense from the 40-yard line, the other team's 40-yard line every time.
That's true. That's going to be a killer. Coming in, trying the extra point. And it was good. He slipped down there a little bit. That was number 12, Peter Boyestet, who got it right through. And it's 14-7 in favor of Maine. 7:42 to go in the first quarter, and we'll be back after this. Maine getting set to kick it off to Georgia Southern. Well, we're as nervous as they are, I guess. It's 14-7 in favor of Maine. 7:42 to go in the first period. Delano, if this keeps up, we better bring the basketball scoreboard over here. It's the only one around with triple digits.
That's right.
Maine getting set to kick it down the field. And this one's going to be just a little bit deeper, or maybe not, as Nate Young takes it on the 10. Comes back across the 20. He's found that hole again. Back across the 30-yard line, up to about the 33. The runbacks have been incredible so far.
He almost broke that one.
Mike Pettit is the guy who was kicking, and I apologize for not having his name earlier, but he is not listed in the program unless they've got him under a different name. As you see, the kickback, as Nae Young takes it, he's backed up to about the 9-yard line and finds that hole again. And almost gets the block he needs once more, but gets it up to about the 31-yard line of Georgia Southern. As Raymond Gross brings him up, Gross is going to give it right to Joe Ross, and Ross is going to get about 2 yards at the most, and it's tough sledding down there before Nick Pinna brings him down.
I think Coach Russell's philosophy is run the option until you die. I think he's going to keep running that. You may not, we very well may not see a pass if it keeps working.
He doesn't like to pass. Irk Russell is not a passing coach. He comes from the old school. He was Vince Dooley's chief defensive coach and assistant for 17 years at the University of Georgia. Raymond's going to change the play again. He's got Joe Ross right behind him. He's got Frank Johnson split out wide right. Johnson goes in motion and is going to be a keeper right there. He pitches it out to Johnson. It was all Johnson could do to catch that ball because he was hit just as he went to pitch, and Keith James was there to bring him down, the defensive back out of Peoria, Illinois.
Well, you mentioned that Coach Russell doesn't like to pass, much to my chagrin, because I was a wide receiver for Georgia.
Delano was a wide receiver. In fact, he was Tracy Ham's primary target for a while, and Rob Allen, who was the starting quarterback beforehand. And you can see just as he got ready to pitch, he was clobbered, and it was very lucky that Frank Johnson was there, or it would have been Maine's football for sure.
The wide receivers do so much blocking that they nicknamed them the wide blockers. Kind of got me mad, too.
Yeah, I can understand why. So Gross is going to throw Georgia Southern's first pass of the day. Goes out in the flats and complete to Ernest Thompson. No, let's see.
Tony Belzer.
Tony Belzer over there on the right side. And Steve Luke, the defensive back from Boston, Mass., got him and ran him out of bounds, but it's going to be good enough for a first down as you watch it. And Raymond rolling out to the right. Belzer's a great receiver. He can catch that ball and take a shot.
He really is. You won't see him drop many, but did you see the way Raymond Gross rifled that out there? It was a perfect tight spiral, as they call it.
They're very, very difficult to defend, and one of the things that I talked with some of the Maine people about, they're worried about their defense being maybe just a little bit shredded.
Well, it looks like both teams' defenses are being shredded here right now.
Isn't that the truth? Frank Johnson in motion to the left. Gross rolling out that way. He may keep it. He's going to. He gets across the 45 to about the 46-yard line before he's knocked down there by Joe Trefethen.
Well, it looked like Ross Worsham broke open early, but Raymond Gross decided to tuck it up and keep it himself.
I believe that's Trefethen. I think I get that right. Joe Trefethen. Joe, if I mispronounced your name, my apologies. He's right there. He's a hometown kid from Orono.
I think that is his name, Joe Trefethen.
No, I talked to their SID about that, sports information director. He said that accent is right on the middle, Trefethen.
Okay.
So, at any rate, well, I'm sure you folks in Maine are delighted to hear that we know how to pronounce your names. straight up the middle to give to Joe Ross. He's got first down yardage across into Maine territory, across the 45 to about the 44-yard line. Nick Penn is the guy who wraps him up again, but not before it's a Georgia Southern first down. And here we go as you watch it once more. Ross just barreling through there. A lot of good power and good speed. If he gets loose, bye.
Of course, he's a freshman as well as Raymond Gross, and it's interesting to note that the University of Maine has a lot of young players on their team, so both of these teams will be back.
5:09 to go in the first period, and folks have already scored 21 points. Maine's got 14 of them. Georgia Southern trying to tie this thing up again as the give is going to go once more to Joe Ross, and there is no place to go. 36 wrapped up by 36. Joe Ross tackled there by Nick Penna once more. And it's going to be second down and 10.
Sorry, Bill, my headset went dead just then. We had to change it.
A few technical difficulties never hurt anybody.
Crowd is still coming in.
This is the best playoff crowd that we have ever had. Usually we've been averaging around 7,600 or so. I'd say we've got close to 10,000 or 12 maybe today. As Raymond Gross is going to go back to pass and going to fire it in the flats and intercepted. Claude Petaway came in there, the defensive back out of Silver Springs, Maryland. And you are going to see it once again. He was looking for somebody who actually got well covered. Petaway is going to be right there.
Ross Worsham was doing a little kind of a curl pattern, and I guess that was outside linebacker. He came over and snuck in and picked it off.
Now, it's hard for me to tell, Delano. You've played this game. When is it the receiver runs the wrong route and makes the quarterback look bad? Was that a situation there?
I don't think so. I just think Gross didn't see the linebacker coming over.
It's hard to do, so Maine's going to set him down here. Maine with a 14-7 lead, and the give is going to be over there to number 33, Doug Dorsey. And Dorsey's going to pick up a couple of yards before Oliver Davis can wrap him up.
I think this game is going to go to the team with the least turnovers because both teams are just marching the ball down at will.
Of the last 3 weeks, Georgia Southern, that is now our second turnover in 3 weeks. Last week when we turned it over, fortunately it was down on the opponent's 1 yard line. And if you're going to turn it over, that's a place to do it, I suppose. We were getting ready to go in for a touchdown, but it's going to be second down and call it 9 yards to go as Buck brings him up once more. Buck back to pass and nobody to go to, so he's just going to run and run to his heart's content before he's finally clobbered and knocked out of bounds over there by Nay Young. But he picked up a first down easily.
Now, I think they told me that Buck was not a scrambler, but he's doing a fine job of it. He's disguising it really well here.
Well, as Irk Russell said before the game, he said that licking his chops. There goes nice pickup on the play. About 13 yards or so?
Nay Young gave him a nice little greeting over there.
Yeah,
on the sideline.
Nay introduced himself. Buck's got him up again. Back to the passing lanes. It's there. Bart Hughes knocks him out of bounds, but not before they pick up a first down. That's Doug Dorsey.
I think Maine is sending their receivers out on some deep patterns, and when Georgia Southern can't control Mike Buck in the pocket and keep him in the pocket, he's scrambling out, and he has plenty of room to run.
And he's such a big kid. I said it was a first down. It's actually second down and six. So it was close. Ball resting inside the 35-yard line of Southern. And Buck is just going to run a little quarterback draw, and then there's nowhere to go that time as he's wrapped up very quickly by Flint Matthews along with who else got in there?
I think it was
Charlie Waller.
Charlie Waller, a big kid. He gets in there and gets tough and gets physical.
Call it third down and five. The defense has really got their backs against the wall this time. This team has scored every time they've had the ball, which has been twice now, but this is the third possession.
We've
still got almost 3 minutes to go in the first period. Bucks looking to go long again. Over there, almost intercepted, intended for Hebra out there. But Oliver Davis darn near came up with that football.
Well, I think that ball surprised Oliver Davis. He turned around, and there was the ball, and he was like, whoa, what's going on?
Yeah. It's not supposed to be here, but there it was. As you see, Buck going back to pass. He's looking for Hebra. And again, that's almost the same thing that that happened to Raymond Gross, and it ricocheted off there a couple of people. Hebra still had another chance to catch it. So it'll be fourth down and five. We got our first punt of the afternoon. They really going to punt? They must not have a kicker of any long distance for a field goal here.
Well, I think it'd be about a 52-yard field goal if they would do that.
I'm just going to try to get it deep. And they're going to get a good bounce out of it, but it's going to go into the end zone, so it'll be Georgia Southern's ball, first and 10 at the 20. And the score is 14-7, 2:34 to play.
Georgia Southern fans are mighty happy that they had that defensive stand that time.
The Southern crowd definitely needed to see that, and Georgia Southern, I think, needed it to build their confidence just a little bit as Raymond Gross brings him out. And split wide to the left is Tony Belzer. Split out wide right is Ross Worsham. And he's got Ernest Thompson and Frank Johnson set as the split backs. Thompson in motion, and Gross is going to keep it rolling over to his right. He's got some running room over there as he keeps it and gets first down yardage across the 30 to about the 31-yard line before John Morrison can bring him down, the outside linebacker.
I think you'll see, Bill, the wide receiver's doing a good job blocking downfield.
Stumbling just a little bit there and managed to catch his balance. Raymond Gross is just an incredible young athlete, a freshman from over at Hinesville, Georgia, just about 30 or 40 miles from here at the most. The give is going to go to Joe Ross, and there is nothing there. Just absolutely nothing. He met a whole group of black bears, including Nick Pinna.
This would probably be a good time for Coach Russell to opt to go for a pass and maybe restore some of Raymond Gross's confidence after throwing that interception on the last drive.
You really need that as a quarterback, don't you, to kind of come back and hit one of your primary targets and pick up a few yards?
I wouldn't be surprised to see a pass right here.
So it's second down and 10. Gross is going to pitch it out to Frank Johnson. Johnson does a little stutter step there and gets outside to the 35, almost to the 40-yard line before he's rolled out of bounds by Rob Sterling. And I'm going to call him Rod Serling before the day's over. And you're going to see it again. Watch the move that Frank Johnson makes.
Ooh, that's nasty. Now you see me, now you don't.
Finally run out of bounds over there by Sterling. Good play, pickup of about five on the play. We'll call it maybe six, call it third down and four.
Frank Johnson doesn't have a lot of speed, but he does have those elusive moves.
Big third down play coming up for Georgia Southern. Punting over the years has not been Georgia Southern's forte, but they've got a freshman, Terry Harbin, who does a good job, and let's see if we're going to see him as the pass goes out to Ernest Thompson and in and out of his hands. And he would have had first down yardage, I believe, over there, but he couldn't hold on to the football, so we do see Terry Harbin coming in, the freshman out of Keystone Heights, Florida. Be standing at about his 20-yard line, 21, to kick it away. Delano, it hasn't been, punting has not been a strong point for Southern in the years that you played, was it?
No, it hasn't. Pat Parker has been doing the punting duties, but Coach Russell decided to go with Terry Harbin in the midway of the season.
Harbin's doing the job, and let's see. There it goes. He gets a nice spiral there. Taken down at the other end on about the 15-yard line, and he's going to be dragged down. I believe it's Jeff Knox that had the ball before Flint Matthews got him down to great speed once again of Flint Matthews and Randall Boone up there. So, with the score 14-7 Maine, we've still got a minute 10 to go in the first quarter, and we'll be back with the action after this. 14-7 Maine, and Maine's got the football. They are back at their own. This is the first time they have started with Georgia Southern in more advantageous field position instead of around midfield. Let's see what happens now. Buck brings him up. He's got Wood and Fox right behind him in the eye. And back to pass he goes. He's going to fire it out there to Fox in the flats, and Fox isn't going to get much. If he gets anything, he may have lost a yard or so. Tyrone Hull had him right there.
There was about five Georgia Southern defenders waiting for him. Did we have anybody on the other side of the field?
I'm not sure. Nay Young also got there as well, and they lost a couple of yards on the play. It's going to be second down and 9. Oh, did they lose a yard? Well, I guess they didn't. Second and 13. Okay, the scoreboard was wrong. I didn't think I was seeing things, but I've been wrong before. Buck brings them up, second down and 13. They're on about their own 13-yard line. And Buck dropping straight back to pass again, and here comes the rush once more, but are they going to get to him? No, he gets away once again as they go down in a heap. And a long pass right up the middle. It's going to be in and out of the hands. He had his hands on it just momentarily. Was Jeff Knox. He'd have had plenty of running room as well. A couple of Georgia Southern players, one to Terry Young and Taz Dixon over there, were hoping they'd catch it off the ricochet, but no such luck for them.
That Buck is a really slippery kid, isn't he?
There you see Coach Irk Russell, the bald eagle himself, as we know him around here. Coach Vince Dooley's assistant for 17 years came down here and started this program literally from scratch. You talk about from the ground up 7 years ago, just incredible.
They had to go out and buy a football.
Yeah, didn't even have a football for the press conference. So 5 minutes before the press conference, they realized, hey, we got to go get one of those things. Back to pass again is Buck, third down and 13. Buck looking right across the middle. Long pass down there that is almost intercepted and batted down by Randall Boone. And he was sticking with the receiver, Tony Lanza, like glue. Here you're going to see it once more. Randall had a good chance to intercept this pass. Decided just to knock it down, I suppose.
They had him covered like a blanket that time.
I mean to tell you. So our first punt of the afternoon from the University of Maine. Steve Bell back there, standing in his own end zone. Not much of a rush, and Bell gets it away. Nice kick that's going to be, they're not even going to try to field it. Tony Belzer just watches it bounce around, and they're going to have good field position, 60 yards away at their own 40-yard line. The nose of the football resting right at the 40, and there's 3 seconds to go in the first quarter. They'll have time to run one play, 14-7 Maine. It has been an offensive show so far, but the defenses have sort of taken over and got a little tired of not being in the spotlight, Delano. So we have had that defensive struggle
you told us about in the last
part of this quarter.
I feel a lot better now.
Of course you do. Raymond Gross brings him up. Once again in motion is Frank Johnson, and the give is going to go straight ahead to Joe Ross. You know, the kid that I'd like to see him bring in as far as Mark Lewis on the stop there. And that's it. The end of the first quarter with Maine leading by a score of 14-7. And we'll be back with the second quarter action after this. The fans here at Statesboro, and Maine brought a great contingent today. In fact, I think you could be looking at some of the folks there who came down, and they brought a little pep band with them and everything. Delano, this is impressive. I like this Maine crowd.
I really do.
Raymond Gross has got him up. First play of the second quarter. Maine's leading 14-7. And a pass to Tony Belzer out in the flats, and he's going to pick up, about 2 or 3 yards maybe. It'll bring up third down and maybe four before Keith James runs him out of bounds over there on the other side. Rob Sterling over there on the play as well.
You know, you're speaking about the Maine fans, but I'm really impressed with the Georgia Southern fans. When I played, back a year ago, I guess it was, I don't think they were that rowdy.
No, and we had only about 5,000 or 6,000 folks here. It was a Thanksgiving weekend, of course, the year before we played Jackson State in our first playoff game here. Not a very big crowd at all, but folks have really warmed up to football in Southern Georgia. And the give is to Ross, and there you see some of the power that he's got as he gets that first down, going down to the Maine 45-yard line. Maybe I guess they're going to mark it at about the 46 before Nick Pena is going to bring him down, and you're just going to see the power of Joe Ross coming in here. Kind of a surprising kid this year. He started off the year in a cast, a freshman. They weren't sure just exactly what his role was going to be. He's got an excellent backup. The kid doesn't have the speed, but Gary Miller is his name, and a very powerful runner. Miller is very good to give Ross a little bit of a rest as Gross brings him up.
Well, a lot of major colleges were after Ross, but he decided to go with Georgia Southern.
Well, we're glad he's here as Raymond Gross drops straight back to pass after the fake and wide open down the sidelines and overthrown is Tony Belzer. And he did get open. The defender over there, Rob Sterling, saying, thank goodness for that.
They set that up very pretty. Tony Belzer did a fake, and Raymond Gross faked the option. That's an option pass, and he was wide open.
Right, John Ballard, he just overthrew him, and he mentioned that once before, that he just gets a little too much air under the ball, and that's just something that's going to come with time. That's just a freshman mistake, because that would have been 6 points without a doubt, and we'd have tied this thing back up. But Maine's leading it 14-7, 13:47 to go in the first half. And Gross is going to keep it there on somewhat of an option and loses the football, and Maine's got it. He was hit hard as he tried to put it away, and Maine came up with it. I believe that's going to be Mike Danino that came up with it, or is it Scott Nason? Okay, they're going to tell us it's Scott Nason now. And here you go as you watch it once more. See, Raymond's just about to put that football away. He tries to get it around him, and he's hit by Andy Nickerson there, and the ball pops loose, and Scott Nason comes up with it.
Well, I think he was getting ready to pitch and decided not to, and as he was bringing it back in, he took the shot.
That's right, trying to get around Nickerson there, and it did not work. So Maine's got the football at their own 46-yard line. And Buck is going to go right to the air, straight across the middle, and he's got Jeff Knox. Knox is at the 45 to the 40. A nice pickup on the play as he gets inside the 40 to the Georgia Southern 38-yard line before Oliver Davis runs him out of bounds.
Jeff Knox, the second leading receiver. He's right behind Sergio Hebra in pass receptions.
First and 10 for the Black Bears.
Jeff Knox wide open. Knox, our wide receiver, sophomore. This is a young Maine team, a young Georgia Southern team. We may see each other again one of these days. Winner of this one plays the winner of the Appalachian-Richmond contest. Maine's already faced Richmond this year, one of the three losses that they had, but this is a different Maine squad as they lost those three games in a row. As the give is going to go up the middle, and our resident Yankee, Rod Eichler, defensive tackle out of Cedar Grove, New Jersey, wrapped him up there and threw him for about a half a yard loss or so. It's going to be second down, and let's call it 11, short 11 anyway.
And you see Coach Murphy on the sideline sending in some offensive plays.
Coach Tim Murphy, as we said earlier, the youngest coach in Division I AA playing against a team coached by a guy almost twice his age. Coach Eric Russell back to pass as Buck once again on second down at 11 across, right across the middle, and getting there a moment too late is the defender, Randall Boone, Scott Venditto.
Randall Boone tried to swipe that down, but he couldn't tackle him because it would have been pass interference, so he made the only move that he could make. He just missed the ball.
Just there a half a second too late, and it's going to be a first down for Maine at the Georgia Southern 26-yard line. And I've got a pro set. Back to pass is Buck. Scrambling around to his right, and he's going to be run out of bounds down there. He picked up some nice yardage before he got run out of bounds, though.
I wish we could get a replay of that and see the block that number 85.
You got it.
That was something else. He wiped him out on the sideline.
Charlie Waller finally comes around, but, boy, watch this scrambling of Buck.
Yeah, I think he's going to get Charlie Waller, I think. Watch Charlie Waller. Boom!
Yeah.
Hello.
Would you say he's seeing a few stars right now?
I think so.
12 and a half minutes to go in the first half. Maine's up 14 to 7, trying to make it 21. They're inside the 20, down to the 18-yard line. The give is going to go straight up the middle of Wood. Wood's got some nice yardage. First down inside to about the 10-yard line of the Eagles. Bart Hughes grabs him. Wraps him up there just outside the 10, where it's going to be first and 10, so they still have a chance to make a first down, as you see, before Bart Hughes could finally get over there and stop that train.
He had a gaping hole. The offensive line controlled the defensive line for Georgia Southern on that play.
As we said, our number one pass rusher is not playing for disciplinary reasons today, James Wildman Carter, so we'll just have to see. The Maine fans on the other side just having a great time so far as Buck rears back and fires and complete at the 4-yard line. Once again, his target, Scott Venditto. And Bart Hughes is the guy there once again to bring him down. So it's going to be second down. Let's call it 4. Venditto, a nice catch. He had to go high to get that one. And the frustration of Bart Hughes was easy to see. Ball inside the 5 at the 4-yard line. A little more than 3 yards to go for a first down, and 4 yards for the TD. 14-7 Maine, 11:24 to go in the first half, we should say. There goes the give, straight up the middle, and there's not going to be much there as Doug Dorsey gets pushed back to about the 5-yard line by Craig Walker.
Well, this is where Georgia Southern really gets tough at. That hard-nosed football, stopping the team when they get inside the 5-yard line.
They've had goal line stands here the last couple of weeks. The last couple of times they played here, at any rate, against James Madison, they had an outstanding goal line stand, and also against Western Kentucky to keep them out of the end zone and also preserve victory, we should say, and they're going to have to do something here. as a third down has arisen. They have still can get a first down out of this. Givens going to go straight ahead to Fox, and Fox is in the end zone, touchdown.
And Georgia Southern is in trouble early.
As old Yogi says, it's getting late early. Give is going to go to Fox and straight through the middle. He followed some nice blocking in there. The guys along the main line did a great job for him. 10:37 to go in the half. 20-7 Maine.
Number 12, Peter Boystead in for the point after.
Peter Boystead comes in, kicks it up, and it's true blue. Maine 21, Georgia Southern 7. 10:37 to go in the first half, and we'll be back after this. It is 21-7 in favor of Maine. We are in the second quarter. 10 and a half, a little over 10 and a half minutes to go, and Georgia Southern is going to have to start doing something to the 12th man trying to get into this thing, Delano. The crowd trying to come to life just a bit. But Southern's going to have to do something shortly.
I think Georgia Southern has to score this time in some way of a field goal or a touchdown to get back in this game before halftime. You know, I have noticed one thing. There have not been any penalty flags thrown yet, I don't believe.
It's set to kick it away, and there she goes. Going to be a short kick that is going to be taken over there. And but there's not much of a run back. Gets it back to about the 25-yard line. That was taken by Donnie Allen, kid on special teams. John Ballard was there quickly to make the stop. And so Georgia Southern will start working it about 74 yards away from trying to close this gap once again to a seven-pointer. Right now, Georgia Southern behind 21-7, and we've got 10 and a half minutes to go in the game, in the first half, that is.
Georgia Southern has hurt themselves with turnovers, a pass interception, and a fumble. And Maine has not made any turnovers. Difference in the ball game.
That's true. Split out wide to the right as Worsham to give is going to be to Frank Johnson on the weak side, strong side of the field. And Frank is going to pick up probably about 6 yards across the 30 before Mike Smith makes the stop. You're going to see it going to Frank Johnson. The fake is going to go up the middle to Ross. A lot of people went with the fake, and Johnson's going to take it. He's got a taped ankle, and he's not up to the speed that that he once was. He was the hero of the championship game 2 years ago against Furman, the guy who caught a pass right in the middle of the field to keep things going and also caught the touchdown pass when Georgia Southern came from behind to beat Furman. 44-42, was that it, Delaney?
That was the score.
I figured you'd know. And Gross is going to keep it this time once again on the option, and there is no place to go. He got wrapped up there immediately. Mike Danino was the guy that grabbed him and knocked him down. Watch Danino come up here. Didn't go for that fake at all.
Raymond Gross had nowhere to pitch the ball to because the pitch man was covered.
So there you see it, 9 and a half minutes to go in the first half. Georgia Southern trailing 21-7.
This is a very important play in the ball game. Georgia Southern needs to pick up this first down and keep the drive alive.
Third down and about four as Gross sets him down and goes back to pass. He's going to give a little shuffle pass, and they've got the first down. Then to number 24, the kid who has just come in here, Carl Miller, a freshman out of College Park, Georgia, before John Gibson can get him. And that little shuffle pass is an interesting play because you're never quite ready for it. It's always scary. Of course, if he drops the ball, it's not a fumble. It's an incomplete forward pass is what makes it so such a dangerous weapon.
But no matter if the ball goes in the ground, most of the fans jump up and scream anyway.
That's right, yeah. Oh, yeah, fumble. Get that thing. First down at the 41-yard line. And the give is going to go straight ahead. Is that Gary Miller who's in there? Gary Miller's come in to give him a rest, and Mike Danino makes the stop on that play after Gary picks up about two or three tough yards just off the right side. There you see Gary Miller, big husky kid. Joe Ross gets a rest, and Raymond's got his play from the sideline. 8:38 to go, first half.
Well, Joe Ross, I'm sure he needs a rest. You take a lot of banging being that fullback position back there in Georgia Southern's run and shoot offense.
I can imagine. There's the give. Once again, it's going to go to Miller. Miller gets away from a couple of guys. Can he get away from three? No. Tony Conquest is a guy who got him after that. He's dancing around there trying to get out of the way. But there really was no place to go, Delano.
Well, the Georgia Southern blocker did a good job of not clipping right here.
Mm-hmm.
The coaches will teach you to not clip. I think it's coming up. He did not hit him in the back. Ross Worsham, I think that was.
Yeah, that's
making
Ross.
Making a smart decision.
He did throw another block, but it was to no avail. And that
right,
guy wasn't
true.
In on it anyway.
But he was doing something.
That's right, yes. He'll get a grade for that. 7:50 to go here in the first half. Clock taken down. It's 21-7. Favor of Maine. It's Gross trying to pass. He's going to run outside. He's going to get a few yards anyway, up across midfield and down and knocks out of bounds as he gets inside Maine territory before Clinton Lawson can get him.
I think that extra lunge at the end may have gave him the first down.
I think he did get it. You could hear the reaction from the crowd as well. And he did indeed. Raymond Gross on a first down run. Watch it. A little lunge here right at the end. He knew exactly where that first down marker was. And there you see him being brought down by Clinton Lawson, but not before it becomes a first down, and they've got the ball right inside Maine territory at the 49-yard line.
That's a lot of savvy from that quarterback. How many more years does he have?
Three years?
Gee, imagine what he could be like in his senior year, barring no injuries.
There's always that, isn't there? Gary Miller, big hole right up the middle. Gary gets away from another person. He goes over there and finally gets it down to about the 20-yard line. A big pickup before Keith James can bring him down. And I tell you, this kid Miller is fantastic.
Now, there's the difference between the running backs, Gary Miller and Joe Ross. Joe Ross may have been able to break that all the way had he been in. But Gary Miller does such a wonderful job of just finding the hole.
Big hole right there. He gets hit. And that was Rob Sterling that got him there. And finally, dragged down from behind by Keith James. Or it was six. So Georgia Southern's got a first down just outside the main 20. The give once again to Miller. He slices off the right side. Once again picks up about 3 or 4 yards before Scott Nason can wrap him up around the ankles and get him down. 7 minutes to go in the first half. 21-7 Maine.
You know, I think the different running backs, Gary Miller, the different styles between Gary Miller and Joe Ross, kind of hurts the defense because they're used to a faster handoff when it's Joe Ross and to a slower handoff when it's Gary Miller's in there, and it kind of confuses the defense.
Marshall is leading James Madison in one of the other playoff games in the first quarter, 7-0. Florida's over Florida State, 14-6, as Raymond Gross rifles one over to Joe Ross. Or not Joe Ross, I beg your pardon. That was Ross Worsham. I knew there was a Ross in there somewhere.
Right.
Scott Ballard is there. John Ballard, I should say, to knock him down. As long as we're getting everybody's name wrong, let's do it that way.
Ross Worsham took a heck of a shot over there.
He did.
Can't lose any more receivers. We've already lost Darren Chandler, who was the starting receiver this year, to a cracked vertebrae earlier in the season.
Chandler was hurt in the Western Carolina game up when we played on that artificial turf. He got slammed to the turf real hard and said, kept complaining about numbness along his right side. That isn't good. 6:37 to go in the first half, 21-7 Maine. Georgia Southern threatening. Gross is going to keep. He gets a couple of yards, but it's going to bring up fourth down and about 3 yards to go. Do we gamble here or we send Tim Foley in? We send in Tim Foley. We got to get some points at this point.
How can you not send Tim Foley in?
That's right. Georgia Southern has got to get in some points. Monique Pinna is the guy who made the stop and prevented a first down. 6:15 in the clock running. 21-7 Maine trying to cut it to 21-10. Tim Foley in to try a 32-yard field goal. He kicked one, a record-breaking field goal of 63 yards here a couple of weeks ago. It's up, and that should be dead solid perfect. It is. Making an 11-point lead for Maine now, 21-10 in favor of the Black Bears. 5:55 to go in the second quarter. We'll be back. Southern trailing 21-10. The University of Maine, who have looked outstanding, or has looked outstanding today.
Well, Bill, I mentioned that Georgia Southern had to go down and get some type of score, and they did. Now it's up to the defense to stop this impressive Maine offensive team.
Impressive is the word. Jim Fox, along with Rob Sterling getting ready to take that ball, and they've decided to send in Tim Foley to maybe get that ball a little deeper. Rob Witten's kicks have not been going very deep, and that's been giving Maine the great field position, plus some terrific runbacks. And Foley's going to kind of squib it along the ground there, and it's finally going to be picked up by Wood, who was the upback at about the 25-yard line. They're still going to, I don't think that's exactly what they wanted to do, did they, Delano?
Yes, I think that is what they wanted to do. When they bring Tim Foley and he's coming in and kick that little squib kick and maybe make it kind of hard for the main offensive backfield back there to get a hold of the ball, because they're getting some long run backs and Coach Russell doesn't like that.
Well, apparently, of course, we're working again once again with a 61-yard field here for the defense, so that's going to hurt. And the way Mike Buck has been moving this team, it's going to be, hold on to your hat. 21-10 is the score. 5:48 to go in the first half. Maine is in the lead. Trying to add to it here. It's about their fifth or sixth possession. Give is going to go straight up the middle. I believe that's Fox that had the ball and got a yard at the most.
Well, Bill, I'd like to say hello to Mr. Dale Lick out there. I know he's probably watching back in Maine and biting his tongue, I imagine.
Dr. Lick, glad to have you aboard. And the Maine resident, Stephen King, and one of your biggest fans. I think you wrote the script of this thing so far, as far as Georgia Southern players and fans are concerned. This is a horror story for us, 21-10. And almost a little over 5 minutes to go in the first half. Maine in the lead, and Buck back to pass. Right, that looks familiar. Flag flies, and Buck trying to get away. He's finally wrapped up and knocked down, and Georgia Southern player came in late and could have cost us something there. Tyrone Hull is the guy who wrapped him up, but a flag went down long before that play got underway.
And usually when it's in that area, it's holding on the offense.
That's the first first penalty flag that we've seen so far. So that's going to cost them, what, 10 yards? And holding 10 yards these days?
I think so, and I think it'll be second down all over again.
Mm-hmm. So we'll call it second down probably in about 20. Or second down in about 16, I guess, 15.
Well, that's really interesting. That's the first penalty flag of the game. Flawless ball. Hard to believe.
It is. Well, I guess, you know, if you tried to get picky, you could call something on every play. The Buck is going to bring him up, and he's got second down and 14.
He dropped back into a shotgun.
That's interesting. Now, we haven't played against a shotgun team this year, so this presents different problems. As Buck really rifles one right down the field, there's Hebra. He's got it. What a catch. Nay Young is the guy who brings him down, but what a throw. And I can see why they went to that shotgun formation.
I think it was to buy a little more time.
Hebra picks it up. It's got to be what? About a 60-yard pass play. 50-yard pass play. Heber's got it just inside the 15-yard line, down to the 14 before Nay Young can bring him down.
Well, I think Heber has a lot of pro scouts looking at him.
I wonder why. Big senior. He told us at the airport today it wasn't going to end here, and if they keep this up, he's absolutely right. Maine, the torch could be passed today. You better do a good job with it. But we still got a lot of football to play as Buck fires one into the end zone and overshoots Jeff Knox over there in the corner. Sticking right with him is Nay Young.
Seems like Georgia Southern has had their back right against the end zone all day long, the Georgia Southern defense.
This is what hurts, because once that defense stays out there for too long with the pass rush that you're trying to put on, you really can get tired, and of course that's when the scores can really get out of hand. As far as Southern fans are concerned, it's out of hand now, 21-10, with 4:16 to go in the first half. Buck's got him up, and he's got Wood right behind him. Buck is going straight back to pass again. Over the middle. In the end zone and out. But the pass is complete at about the 2 or 3 yard line. It's going to be complete in there to Scott Venditto before Calvin Robinson can crack him down. Oliver Davis coming out, and you can watch it again. He was in the end zone but had to come back for this football. Otherwise, the score would have been 28-7 at this point. Looked like he had about 1 foot in there. Maybe he didn't. Maybe just our angle. But they've got first and goal at about the 1 yard line, and it's time for goal line stands, Bill, but not the way it's been going so far. Gibb is straight up the middle, and he's not going to get in. That's Wood, who gets clobbered just as he gets to the line of scrimmage. And there was nothing there. Let's say everybody from the Georgia Southern team just about.
Coach Russell pacing the sideline. He may be getting a little nervous at this point.
Well, you can't go in with 3.5 minutes to go, and they're about to go up 28-10. That's extremely difficult to come back from, but we both talked about these teams, and you see Irk, and there you see how close that ball is there as you watch from our ground camera. Buck's got him in tight. Southern's in tight. The give is going to go, and no place to go is Doug Dorsey. Nay Young wrapped him up right at the line of scrimmage, so it's going to be third down and goal. Once again, the Southern folks can smell that goal line stand again.
And it really pumps the team up in general for the defense to do good. The offense gets pumped up, the coaches get happy, the fans get excited.
There's nothing practically more exciting, and you can see just how close that football is on a goal line stand. Big play here for Maine and Georgia Southern, needless to say. The give is going to go, and Ron Wood just can walk in. Ray Wood, I should say.
That big offensive line for Maine just blew the Georgia Southern defense out.
Really did. Opened up an interstate there. Ray could have walked in. I could have carried that one. 2.5 minutes, a little over 2.5 minutes to go, and Maine's gone up 27-10.
Well, now Georgia Southern is in the same situation. They need to go back down and score again.
That's right. Tried to block it, but no dice. Flag goes down. And let's see what this is all about. I believe it's against Southern. Personal foul probably assessed on the kickoff.
That hurts.
Point is good. So it's 28-10, 2:37 to go.
The penalty will be assessed on the kickoff.
And they will assess the penalty on the kickoff. So that's not going to help either. And we'll keep it here. Georgia Southern trailing right now, 28-10. I do not believe that that they've trailed this much in a game so far this year. But we'll be back after this. University of Maine in the lead, 28-10. 18 points to overcome in a hurry, Delano. 2:37 to go in the first half. Florida State is trailing Florida 14-6 in the second quarter. Another of the playoff games today in the first quarter. Marshall has taken a 10-0 lead over James Madison. What Marshall, it's the champion of the Southern Conference? Or co-champion?
I think so.
2:37 to go as Maine gets set to kick it away. They kick it from the 50-yard line, and this thing's going to go into the next county. A little further over, he'd have had 3 points. So Georgia Southern will start at their own 20 with 2:37 to play in the first half and trailing by 18. 28-10 is the score in favor of Maine, and they have looked impressive.
Well, the Maine fans look mighty satisfied over there.
Well, shouldn't they be? This is a long trip to come down and lose.
That cowbell's ringing mighty loud.
Yeah, isn't it, though? Telling you, they must have run into a Mississippi State fan somewhere along the way. Now you see the clock, 2:37 to play as Raymond Gross brings him up. He's got Joe Ross right behind him. He's got Ernest Thompson split out one direction. Ross Worsham split out the other, and Tony Belzer even further out than that. And the give is going to go to Ross, and Ross is going to get about 6 or 7 yards as he comes across the 25 to about the 27-yard line before Rob Sterling can bring him down.
Get a replay on that and watch the determination by Joe Ross. I'm not sure if we can.
2:21 to go. Well, we do have a freeze frame out.
Yes.
If anybody wants a 35-millimeter slide. Second down, about 3. Give is going to go to Ross again. He's going to get very close to first down yardage at the 30 before he finally falls down. I'm not sure where they're going to spot the ball. There was just a whole pile of folks right in the middle there. Nick Pinna. Joe Trefethen.
I like how you say that name, bro. Sounds good.
Trefethen?
Yes.
That's a neat name, isn't it? Wonder what that is.
I'm not sure.
As far as origin goes. I know he's from Orono, Maine, but I'm not sure what the origin of Trefethen is, or Trefethen. Gross is going to give it to Ernest Thompson. Thompson's got first down yardage and a big 5 or 6 more yards after that. He gets it across the 35-yard line. They may spot it just outside the 35. Claude Petaway is the guy who came over to make the stop. 1:24. The Eagles are going to call a timeout with 1:24 to go. 28-10 is the score in favor of Maine, and we'll be back after this. Hey, everybody, we're back here, and somebody... They're on camera, and they could care less. Minute 24 to go. It's 28-10 in favor of Maine. And here we go. Marshall leading 17-0 over James Madison in the second quarter. Georgia Southern trying to get some points up here before halftime. Raymond Gross scrambling around looking for somebody to go to and almost has it intercepted by a diving Claude Petaway.
Had a bunch of people running around back there, and you couldn't find anybody open.
Looked like a little bit of confusion there. I'm not sure. 1:16 to go. 28-10. Maine in the lead. And they have dominated this football game since the kickoff. Came down and scored the first 2 times they had the ball, right? Georgia Southern scored the first time they had it. And the 3rd time, I think, coming down and kicking a field goal. The Black Bears have been impressive as Gross goes back to pass. Firing it out in the flats. I think it was supposed to go to Tony Belzer or Herman Barron. Barron got knocked down, and everybody is yelling for pass interference, but no dice. Covering on the play over there was Mike Smith. And you can hear the Boo Birds come out of the closet in a hurry on that. But the pass was not, I believe, Barron got knocked down.
Looks like
there is a flag down, but I'm not sure what they're calling. They're talking to Maine. And we're getting charades out there.
Holding on the offense, 10 yards, second down and 20.
So that's really going to bring the Boo Birds out. Not only did they penalize Georgia Southern, everybody thinks that they should have had pass interference, at least offsetting penalties. But no such luck.
And they're not on the field with striped shirt on.
No, they're the only guys that have a vote out there, aren't they? We got 70 seconds to go in the first half of this one. 28-10 in favor of Maine. Boy, they've looked good. I'm impressed with these guys. You realize 20 pounds of lobster against 20 pounds of Georgia hams on the line for this? Little shuffle pass goes in there to Frank Johnson. Johnson gets to about the 30-yard line. Another flag goes down.
Pass complete to 38, Frankie Johnson.
Well, we asked for it. We mentioned that there had not been a penalty flag thrown for quite a while, and now that
All of a sudden it's raining.
Yes.
And there's going to be another holding call against Georgia Southern.
Preliminary indication against the Eagles.
One of the things that has hurt Georgia Southern all season long has been penalties, and I know there's never a good time for them, Delano, but they have come in the worst possible time.
On the third down.
Okay, Maine's decided they'll go ahead and take the down rather than take the penalty since they only picked up about 4 yards on the play anyway.
I think there's some ulterior motives behind that. I think Maine may want to get the ball back before halftime and try to get a field goal or maybe even a score.
You think so?
I think so.
I wish I'd thought of that. It's going to be third down and about 15, so I'd say a big third down play coming up. As you see right there on the clock, 1:02 to go in the first half. We'll be talking with Bucky Wagner, the athletic director here at Georgia Southern, at halftime as Joe Ross is going to go up the middle for about 4 more yards and not risk anything. Mike Smith brings him down after about a 4-yard pickup, so it's still going to be what, fourth down and 11?
Yes, I think so.
Your attention, please. Andrea Rogers.
I'm surprised that Coach Russell didn't go for a pass that time.
Andrea Rogers.
Hebra and Knox back deep. As Terry Harbin will come in to punt it away. They were planning some. Now, what is the coach talking to him about down there, Delano? They have a little powwow just before coming out on the field with the punting team. What's the what kind of discussion are we having on there? If you let this guy score, I'm taking your scholarship. Is that the type of deal?
I don't know, Bill. They never let me around the punting team. They told me to go sit on the end of the bench.
I see. They didn't want you taking that thing, huh?
Kind of like a pep talk. Just go out there and tackle somebody.
Now give me the difference between being a wide receiver and going after it and catching a long pass as opposed to catching a punt. Now, how much different can it be?
It's much scarier to catch that punt when that ball's coming from, high
outer
up in
space.
The air, and you can't see the people coming towards you. I shudder to even think about doing that.
This guy's coming down on you like freight trains. Standing at about just inside the 19-yard line is Terry Harbin getting ready to punt it away for Georgia Southern. Knox and Hebert back deep for Maine. And it's going to be Hebert that's going to take it at the 30. Hebert trying to get away, dances around, and loses a couple of yards. Coming in and submarining under there. It looked like Stan Stipe? Smallest guy in the world? Good heavens. How in the world did that happen?
But he's tough.
Yeah, oh, there's no doubt about it.
You know, that Hebra fella has some mighty big arms to be a wide receiver.
Doesn't he, though? I'm surprised they risk a guy like that back there on punt coverage, but I guess you got to get somebody back there. 46 seconds to go, and Maine's probably going to try to put up some more numbers. Here goes Buck. God, this guy's amazing. Pass right over there to Hebra. They've got a first down.
Well, there seems to be no pass rush.
Oliver Davis. Well, they haven't, they're using too much energy on the pass rush. Of course, if they keep giving them shots like that, then what the heck? 36 seconds, 28-10, Maine. Back to pass again is Buck. They're going to try to get some more, at least a field goal before halftime. Going to go shallow. And there to, was that Venditto, Scott Venditto, yeah, okay. Oakdale, Connecticut, Bart Hughes gets him. 26 seconds to go now.
Oliver Davis was kind of responsible for stopping some of his speed over there on the sideline.
What kind of field goal kicker do they have? You know, we tried to get somebody from Maine here in the booth with us. Honest to goodness, we did. And he didn't make the trip. 28-10 and just under a half minute to go in the first half. Maine is in the lead. Back to pass is Buck. Going to go straight down the middle. He's got somebody, and in and out of the hands of Serge Hebra. And Serge doesn't miss many like that. He was wide open. Oliver Davis was there to defend on the play, but Serge would have easily had a first down. As it turns out, it's going to be third down now and still about 6 yards to go. 19 seconds to play.
No, he doesn't miss many of those.
There are a couple I could suggest that for Georgia Southern fans that they wish he had missed earlier.
That's true.
long thing that he caught a minute ago.
Well, I guess the only positive thing for Georgia Southern right now is they'll be getting the ball at the beginning of the second half.
So Maine has decided that they're going to call a timeout and talk the situation over with 19 seconds to play in the first half and leading by 18 points. 28-10 is the score here. Third down and 6, and discuss their strategy. What would you do here, Coach Delano?
Well, I would probably just fall on the ball and let the time run out and go in halftime with a 28-10 lead and let Georgia Southern think about it in their locker room.
These guys haven't shown any signs of wanting to fall on the football yet. I'll tell you, I had a funny feeling about this game. I'm glad all that worry about losing hadn't gone to waste so far.
Well, the University of Maine was kind of a quiet team that came into town and didn't make much noise like other teams that Georgia Southern has played in the past. And those kinds scare you.
That's true. We played a team last year, Arkansas State, for the championship that we absolutely, you know, those guys made some statements in the press that just made your skin crawl. We wanted to beat Arkansas State so badly we could taste it. Maine hadn't done that. They've been quiet, and they're going about their business with quiet efficiency right over the middle. And hitting, what is it? Hitting him in the helmet.
That's the second time that this happened.
Hitting Randall Boone right in the helmet in a pass that was intended for Vendetto.
I tell you one thing, he is on his man. He can't be denied that. He is really sticking to his man. He's not even looking at the ball.
That's true. Playoff scores. Appalachian State 3-0 over Richmond in the first quarter. Marshall 17-0 over James Madison. I'm kind of surprised at that score in the second quarter and at the half in Division One. The guys that get all the publicity like they need it. 14-9 in favor of Florida over Florida State. Definitely an upset in the making in that one. So, Maine is going to go punting again. It's only the second time they've punted this afternoon. That's Steve Bell standing back there, and he gets it away. Not too deep, but they didn't need it too deep. And it's taken there, and down he goes. John Gibson is going to bring down Tony Belzer right away at the 22-yard line. There's 4 seconds to play. Would you do fall on the ball here, Delano? You certainly don't want to risk an interception or something like that, and I'm running back for a touchdown.
Of course you fall on the ball. You're talking about Coach Russell, a man who sometimes punts on third down if the occasion is willing to.
Yeah, that was an old tactic of Bobby Dodd at Georgia Tech, was when you got deep in your own territory and third down, said, let's don't make any mistakes down here. Let's go ahead and get rid of that football, and sometimes it worked great. Caught a lot of teams by surprise.
Sometimes it didn't.
And that's true, too. Sometimes you feel like a nut, and sometimes you don't, as Raymond Gross goes back to pass, just running around as the time is out, and Gross just takes off. And he's got about 10 yards here, and he's just going to fall down. Well, he gets a little help from Mike Smith as the first half comes to an end. 28-10 in favor of the Maine Black Bears. And, folks, they look like $1 million so far. Now we'll be back to talk with Bucky Wagner, the athletic director at Georgia Southern College. We'll also be talking with Dr. Dale Lick from his home at the University of Maine, among other things, coming up here on the Georgia Southern University of Maine NCAA playoff game, 28-10 in favor of the Black Bears. We'll be back after this. But look at the difference in the passing yards. 28 for Georgia Southern, 196 already from Maine. And total plays, of course, there are 188 yards for Georgia Southern, 264 for Maine, and both teams have fumbled. Georgia Southern has fumbled once and lost it. And there we go. The turnover is an interception, and Gary Miller is going to take the ball up close on a short kick. He goes across the 35-yard line and gets down to about the 37 before John Gibson wraps him up there.
Tackled by number 36, John Gibson. It's first and 10 for the Eagles. Starting backfield in the second half.
So the ball starts at the 37-yard line of Georgia Southern as Maine gets ready to try to defend that 18-point lead, and we are sure they are going to try to add to it as well. Georgia Southern needs a touchdown here or something to get back in this ball game. And Joe Ross comes up, and we've got Frank Johnson in motion, and Ross gets the call, and he gets about 3 yards across the middle, and they are tough.
Carried to the Eagle 40-yard line. Tackle made by number 95, Mark Lewis.
Mark Lewis and Scott Nason in on the tackle. So again, that halftime score, Florida's ahead of Florida State by a score of 14-9. And somewhat of a surprise so far. This one a surprise as well for Georgia Southern fans as Gross fakes it into the middle, cuts up field. He's across midfield and down to the 45 of Maine, picking up about 15 yards on the play on that one. Andy Nickerson finally ran him out of bounds, the outside linebacker from East Holden. There you see the replay is turning on the speed. The fake went up the middle to Ross, and that's what they went for. Appalachian State now with a 10-3 lead over Richmond in the second quarter. Marshall's up over James Madison 24-0. 28-10 here in favor of Maine. Georgia Southern trying to do something about that as Ross kind of skips over the middle there for a couple of yards off left guard. Nick Penna again on the stop from Bloomfield, New Jersey. Big junior there. He wants to do that, and again, we've said, you know, he's not a passing coach. He doesn't like to pass, but sooner or later, if they don't score here, we're just going to have to go to the air lanes. There's no other two ways about it.
Let's go, Raymond!
Raymond's got him set, and Frank Johnson goes in motion. Raymond's going to keep it, and he's not going to get very much.
Close on the keeper to the 41-yard line.
Clinton Lawson brought him down.
Pickup
of about 5 yards on the play. Call it the third down and five. Second half just underway. 13:15 to go in the third period. 28-10. Maine's in the lead. Georgia Southern driving. Raymond Gross is going to give it off to Frank Johnson on a little cross buck there. He gets up and going to get down to about the 35-yard line before he's brought down, and very close. I think he got the first down as the crowd really comes to life here. Scott Nason brings him down along with Nick Penna. First down, Georgia Southern. As you see it, the fake is going to go to Ross, back over to Johnson. Johnson cuts back inside and picks up the first down yardage. Georgia Southern fans trying to get the team back into this ball game, and they really do need to score here, Leleno, if they're gonna do anything this afternoon. Frank Johnson started to go in motion left and then stopped, and the give, no, Raymond Gross is gonna keep it. Stumbles a little bit. He got tripped up in the backfield initially over there by a Mike Danino, and Nason finally got him down. But credit Danino with tripping him up and slowing that play down. That'll scare you to death, won't it? Third period score, Florida State still trails the University of Florida. Must be the field goal bowl, 14 to 12 in that one, in favor of the Gators. 12 minutes to go in the third quarter of this one. Maine up by 18 as Gross goes back to pass, goes right down the middle to nobody. That was intended for Frank Johnson, but Johnson cannot run, doesn't have the speed that he has had in the past. He's got a heavily taped ankle, and I'm not sure which one it is, Delano. They tape those things up so tightly and then put the sock over it. Well, I guess that can be said for all of us. Just inside 12 minutes to go in the third period, and Georgia Southern is faced with a third and long, third down and eight. Ball resting just at the 33-yard line of Maine. Third down play here. Once again, the little cross is going to go to Ernest Thompson. Thompson's got first down yardage as he slices off the right tackle and gets down to about the 25-yard line before Mike Smith can trip him up there. First down, Eagles. Yeah, he can fall 5 yards, can't he? That's a tall kid. 28-10. Georgia Southern driving. Maine's in the lead. The fake. Nope, they're going to give it to Ross. Ross is going to get across the 20, picking up about 5 yards, maybe six, before Claude Petaway stops him. Mark Lewis, once again, watch the power of Ross. I thought he faked it in there. He went in so smoothly. Well, those linemen don't get enough credit, do they? Guys down there, the sort of the faceless guys in the trenches that are getting beat up all the time. He's referring to Ronald Warnock, and we'll give you his story here in a moment as Raymond Gross fumbles the football and then falls right on it. Could have been disaster there. And it'll bring up a third down and about six, but Raymond falling on, that's the first missed exchange that they've had today, and you can watch it again. And there was a mad scramble there, the main player just a little bit late. That was 86 Russ Constantino looking in there. They were indeed. If Constantino had seen that thing sooner, bye. Third quarter just underway, 10 and a half minutes to go. The pitch is going to go to Joe Ross on the outside. Ross is up to the 20. He's into the 15 and down to about the 10-yard line of the University of Maine. Nick Pinna, and somebody's dropped something. One of the officials has his hat off, and he's pointing to Georgia Southern, so I think it's all going to go for naught here. Clipping penalty against the Eagles, and we had talked about this, how they shoot themselves in the foot time after time. They've been able to overcome it in some cases, but I don't think we've been behind this far this season. Mm-hmm. It is so difficult to avoid those things at times. Linemen at times, and I'm not saying this
Clipping
is the case here,
on
but
the
linemen
offense,
at times
15
are
yards, it'll still be third down.
15-yard penalty. That hurts. Brings the ball back outside the 40 to the 43-yard line. So here you were faced with a first down, it looked like about the 10-yard line or at least at the 15, and they bring it all the way back out to the 43. When they mark off those 15-yarders, you don't think the guy's ever going to stop walking, do you? That's true. Folks, if we refer to Georgia Southern as we once in a while, my apologies to you up there in Maine as the ball is complete as Raymond Gross throws a nice pass in there to Herman Barron. And Herman Barron's wrapped up there by Drew Trefethen. Down to 9.5 minutes in the first and the third quarter now. It's 28-10 in favor of Maine. And they got to bring on Tim Foley on a fourth down situation. It's going to be fourth down and about 16 yards. So Foley is going to come in and try one from about, what's that, about a 48-yard field goal. Coming down, kick is up, and that's going to be nowhere close. He didn't get that one. He's been hitting them real well the last few weeks. But, boy, that could be typical of the whole day. And so another Georgia Southern threat goes by the boards. The University of Maine up 28-10. We've got 9:13 to play in the third period, and we'll be back after this. And once again, we're back here with Maine leading by a score of 28-10 over Georgia Southern. 9:13 to play in the third period. When the Maine plane got here on Wednesday, we went out and met them and talked to the guys. And Serge Heber said, "Boy, just once, I'd like to have a big lead and be comfortable." Well, they've got that so far. Trying to clear up here just a little bit as Buck goes rolling out to his right, looking for somebody to throw it to, and finally gets rid of the football, and it's almost complete in and out of the hands of the intended receiver. Bart Hughes was down there, but that was just nothing but Jeff Knox dropping the football, although a lot of pressure put on by Jeff Banks, and it is hard. He's one of the few players that we've got, Delano, that's as tall as Mike Buck, and Buck had a little difficulty seeing over him. I don't think he's used to that. Yeah. Somebody told us that. They were obviously lying.
He didn't
lying.
Have a clue, did he?
I mean to tell you. We'll meet him after the game. 9:04 to go in the third period with Georgia Southern down by 18 points and Mike Buck trying to make more of that on second down and 10 as he fires one right over the middle. It's intercepted by Flint Matthews at the 30 down to the 27-yard line. The first big break for Georgia Southern this afternoon.
That blitz caused that. Georgia Southern came out with an all-in-out blitz that time, and it kind of confused Mike Buck, and he made an error.
Don't think he was ready for that as you see him drop back to pass, and Flint Matthews, we've told you, is always around the football, and here you see it. Flint goes high in the air to pick this one off, and he's good at that.
Now watch something. Flint Matthews, he's not used to having that ball. He's holding that ball like a loaf of sunbeam bread.
That's right.
But at any rate, he held on to it, and Georgia Southern has got a golden opportunity down here with just under 9 minutes to go in the third period and trailing 28-10. The ball just inside the main 30. Raymond's going to keep it on the option. Rolls out, and there's very little there. Scott Nason wraps him up. Who else did I see in there? Lewis. Mark Lewis got him. Nose guard out of Bangor.
You can probably call that the whole team.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah. Yeah, pretty much. Boy, enjoy seeing those highlights of Maine at halftime. That's a beautiful campus. Never been up in that area of the country. I'd love to come sometime. And the give is going to go. No, it's going to be a pitch outside to Ernest Thompson. Thompson's going to get it across the 25 to probably about the 24 or 3-yard line, depending on where they spot it before Claude Petaway can ram him out of bounds.
He had a big hole to the inside that time, and I guess he elected, he saw more room to the outside.
There was, I guess he had so much momentum at that point, you just, as long as you're traveling in that direction, the best thing to do is to keep going that way. Now let's see if the old Eagle Express can get cranked up here.
Somebody's up here in the booth messing with me, laughing at me, and it's kind of confusing me.
I see. Handoff is going to go, a little crossbuck there that is not going to work very well to Ernest Thompson, and he is tripped up almost right away by Nick Pena. Pena got him and came up and said, yeah, I did that. Number 36, it's fourth down, and Georgia Southern's going to have to do something. I think they're going to decide not to go for the field goal here. They will go for it on fourth and five.
This is a big move by Coach Russell.
The crowd likes it. I guess he figures you've got to do something at this point. You're down by a score 28-10, and Foley just missed a relative chip shot for him that was way off.
Here you go, Bill. Roll out to the left and let Raymond Gross run it for the first down.
Okay. There it is. No, he's going to throw it. And he's got Ernest Thompson wide open at the 10-yard line. You call that one perfectly.
What a wonderful play. He just
Rob
decided
Sterling.
To fake them out and throw the ball.
Rob Sterling knocked him down at that point. It's going to be first and goal just inside the 10-yard line. That was a great play. He looked like he was going to do exactly what you said, and all of a sudden three guys were bearing down on him in more ways than one.
And it left Ernest Thompson wide open.
Fired at the number 12, Ernest Thompson, that you see there on the sidelines. He comes out, and the trainers look at him for just a second. I hope he's just coming off for a breather here. As Gross is going to give it to Ross. Ross slices off the right side and gets inside the four down to about the 3-yard line. Well, they might just spot it back around the five. But let's see.
And the fans smell a touchdown.
Ball resting just inside the 5-yard line where it'll be second and goal from that point. 6:50 to go in the third period. Maine's up 28-10. Raymond Gross is changing a play at the line of scrimmage. There's a get to Thompson. Touchdown. Thompson went slicing off that right side. Big hole opened up there by the Georgia Southern line. And you can see it again as Thompson comes over to the sidelines for another breather. And well-deserved as he goes slicing off there on the right side. They grabbed him a little too late. And we talked about Ronald Warnock, the guy that opens the holes in there for Georgia Southern, one of the linemen. He was injured in a motorcycle accident. Was it back in April?
I think Delano? It was back
April
in
or May. It was very late in the year as far as the school year goes, or just after school was out. And the skin was literally burned off of about 70% of his body.
That's correct.
And they are going to go for 2 points here. With a 16-28, trailing 16-28. And Gross is going to roll out to his right, looking for somebody to throw it to, and he's going to dance into the end zone for the two-pointer to make it a 10-point advantage in favor of Maine. 28-18 is the score. Here you see it once again. He's rolling out for a second. It looked like he wanted to pass, and that could have thrown the Maine defenders off just long enough for Raymond to sneak in there and get it across the goal line as we see it again in slow motion. Ernest Thompson in motion to the right. Looking to pass for a second, and then sees the opening. Dances inside and between the defenders. And Raymond Gross has 2 points, and we've got a 10-point ball game. 28-10 in favor of Maine with 6:34 to go. And we'll be back after this. Nothing in Division I is as exciting as far as I can tell. 28-18 in favor of Maine over Georgia Southern. Southern has just cut the Maine lead to 10 points as Tim Foley gets ready to kick it away. And Jim Fox back to receive along with Rob Sterling. Jeff, it's going to Fox. He's going to take it at about the 10-yard line and drops it. Picks it up at the 12, across the 15, and just does get back toward the 20-yard line. In fact, they're probably going to place it down at the 19 before Bruce Holbrook of the special teams comes in and gets him along with Jeff Smith.
Terry Young for Georgia Southern was having a little confrontation with one of the players from Maine, and they came over and restrained Terry and said, come on, don't do that. We don't need any stupid penalties at this time.
That is true. Any penalty is stupid, I guess. 6:28, but certainly something like that. As good a field position as Maine has had most of the day, this is one of the least advantageous they've had so far, as Mike Buck brings him up, and he's going to give it straight up the middle to Fox, and Fox has got nowhere to go. Rod Eichler from Cedar Grove, New Jersey, said, not a chance in the world. As you watch it again, watch Eichler. Attendance almost 10,000. We said it looked like there were about 10,000 here. 9,440.
And right now, most of them are cheering and on their feet.
Except the folks sitting on the banks over there.
And the University
Russell
of Maine.
Just loves that, yeah.
Sitting down right now.
Chance of defense right below us while the Maine fans are all on their feet, ringing the cowbells and anything else they can do to try to get this team pumped up. They don't want to see the momentum shift. Back to pass. Over to Heber in the flats across the 26-yard line. He's run out of bounds over there by Terry Young. And right behind him, Bart Hughes. Hughes having a good afternoon.
Like it might be third down and three or third down and four.
At any rate, we're talking about Ronald Warnock with third and four is the case. Motorcycle accident, had 70% of the skin removed from his body, and they didn't think he was going to play football again. For a while, they weren't sure if he was going to live.
But he said, no,
yeah,
I'm going to play football.
Mm-hmm. And he was back in the fall. Had to play heavily taped, but he was here. The give is going to go in there to Wood. Wood's got very little running room. He gets about to the 30-yard line. Flint Matthews trips him up at that point, and it's fourth down and about less than a yard. Maine may try something here. I don't know if they want to.
May not be a good idea at this point, but.
No, may not.
But we're not coaching.
That's true. They're going to call for a measurement. I think we heard some boo birds, of course, come out of the woodwork here.
And I don't think they made it.
They may have been booing the spot of the ball. I'm not sure. They didn't make it by about a foot. Fourth down. Maine's going to punt.
Coach Russell is out on the field right now. He's trying to get his punt return team in. Taking Tony Belser out and putting Nate Young back.
All right, Nate Young we haven't seen since the first of the year as far as returning punts since the Florida A&M game. Georgia Southern lost that one. Nate had been the number one punt returner up until that game and then dropped a couple of them. So we'll just have to see. Steve Bell gets it away, and he gets away a nice one. They're just going to let it hit, and it bounces sideways and right out of bounds. So Georgia Southern will have relatively good field position at the 32-yard line. 5:10 to go in the third period. 28-18, Maine. And the Georgia Southern fans are now finally beginning to really get into this ball game.
You know, we mentioned that about Ronald Warnock and the amazing story. He also, about a month afterwards, he cornered a criminal, supposedly, and held him until the police could get there and arrest him.
No kidding.
It's amazing.
I got to talk to the sports information people. I didn't even hear about that. Well, I'll tell you, I wouldn't want to get cornered by that little guy. He is just a fire plug, if there ever was one, and just tough as nails, obviously.
I think the Raymond Gross story is something to be noted, too. He had to come here and live down the Tracyham era. And I think that was very difficult for a freshman quarterback to handle that. But he's come in, he's matured throughout the season, and he has a chance to lead the team to a third national championship.
That's true. And, of course, you folks up in Maine probably even heard about Tracy Ham, just a fantastic quarterback that a lot of people were sporting for the Heisman Trophy. But, again, these kids in this division do not get the exposure and the publicity that they richly deserve. And, of course, I know the networks go for the big bucks and everything, but I swear if they could get people watching this stuff, I think Division I would suffer. The give is going to go over to Ross. Ross is going to slice over for about 4 or 5 yards, getting up to at least three. He gets across the 35-yard line, and they spot it at the 36 before Mark Lewis gets him. And limping out is Scott Nason. Nason comes out favoring, I think, the right leg just a little bit. And we're shuffling several people in and out. Troy Conquest comes in.
Wild Man Carter down in the sideline, waving a towel, trying to get the team up.
Wild Man, as we had told you earlier, is the number one pass rusher, but is not playing for disciplinary reasons. And Raymond Gross is going to take it and pitch it just as he's hit and gets another couple of yards. Boy, he really sacrificed himself on that one. Steve Luke finally runs Ernest Thompson out of bounds, but they pick up pretty close to first down yardage on the play, or is it? As we go into the replay here and watch, just as he's hit in the back, it almost looked like a fumble, but he was intending to do that all along. And Ernest Thompson gets first down yardage as the ball goes up to about the 43-yard line.
I imagine things like that give Coach Russell a fit when he sees that ball come out.
Coach Russell, what are you talking about? Everybody else in the stands, at least on this side. 4:34 in the third quarter, 28-18, Maine. A give is going to go to Ross, and Ross is going to get another 5-6 yards up there, getting very close to midfield. John Morrison, the outside linebacker, is going to come in and get him. You can see Ross going in there, just the power again. Because of that height, he and Ernest Thompson can both fall 3 or 4 yards. Ticking down to 4 minutes left in the third quarter. The give is going to go to Thompson on the cross. He is not going to go anywhere. He was given a nice ride there to Andy Nick Pinna. Nick Pinna rides him down from behind. Third quarter score, Florida State's finally taking the lead over Florida, 20-14. Richmond trails Appalachian State 13-3. Marshall, and that's at the half. In the third quarter, Marshall 24-0 over James Madison. Arkansas State getting whipped by Jackson State, who I don't believe has ever won a playoff game. They're in the playoffs all the time, Delano, but Jackson State has never won, as far as I know. But they might be on the way. 10-0 in the first quarter in that one. Raymond Gross rolling left to pass. He's got a man open, Tony Belzer. A first down over there near the main 43-yard line, a 44.
Belzer does a good job of getting down and not taking a tremendous blow from a defensive back.
Rob Sterling's going to finally bring him down, as you can see at the end of the line here, but Belzer wide open in the flats.
Watch him get down there. No, don't hit me.
Sterling coming over very quickly, but it was moot by that time. 3 minutes to go in the third quarter. Gross wants to move Frank Johnson up just a little bit as Ernest Thompson goes in motion right, and he's rolling out to pass to the right. He's got Ross Warsham open again. Too much air under the football. Again, that freshman mistake, and you can see from Raymond's reaction that he's standing over there. He is awfully mad about that, as you can see it again.
When you've got a guy that wide open, you just kind of have to kind of lay it up, not throw it so much on a line like he did, and let him run under it.
Yeah, there was no particular rush either. You know, he could have taken his time to throw that ball, and Warsham has shown in the past that he knows how to catch him. So it's going to be second down and 10 with 2:49 to play.
Good effort by Warsham diving for that ball. I like to see that.
Don't you, though? A lot of desire here as Raymond looks like he's called an audible. Gibb is going to go to Ross, and Ross is going to power his way for about 3 tough yards in the middle before Russ Constantino gets him. It'll be third down and long. Third down and about 7 yards to go.
Everyone standing on the other side of the field.
I can't blame them.
I see no reason why they should have even put seats in here.
I'd be standing here, but we got a little bar in the way here on the windows that would keep it from seeing. All you can do to stay in your seat.
We can stand and use a little Windex on these windows too.
That's true too. Gross back to pass again, still looking for that first down yardage, being chased. He's going to run with it this time. He's got the first down. He's going to go to the 30. He could go. He's going to finally be chased out of bounds over there before finally being run down from behind by Keith James, who finally got the angle on him. And we'll take another look at it.
I think Raymond Gross is saying, Mike Buck, I can scramble too.
He can indeed. And you can see why we're so proud of this freshman kid down here. looking out to pass, and who'd have thunk it, all of a sudden he starts going the other way and gets away from everybody. It was good pursuit on that one. Here comes Keith James just saying, I got to get this guy.
And smart. He gets down on the ground and doesn't take the abuse.
Yeah, they've learned to wear those flak jackets now, haven't they? Not to get so much. And the give is going to go to Gary Miller. Miller bursts off the right side, getting good yardage down there before Joe Trefethen wraps him up. A minute and a half to go in the third quarter. 28-18 the score. Maine in the lead. But Georgia Southern trying to cut it some more as you see Gary go slicing off the right side there.
It was a gaping hole. My mother could have ran through that.
Yeah, couldn't
and speaking
she,
of her, I'd like to say hi to her. Yeah?
All right.
And my dad.
Hi, Mr. Little. Mrs. Little. Hi to you folks in Maine, too. Guys, we're glad to have you along, and your team has really done great, and we're glad to see that our Georgia Southern boys are finally coming to life here, too. I know you're not, but Raymond throws that one right into the ground. He had Frank Johnson open, but he is so upset with himself. 56 seconds now to play in the third period. And just threw that one because Johnson was wide open. Did some nice yardage, so it'll bring up third down and three.
Tim Foley kind of pacing the sideline. He's probably eager to want to get in and kick another field goal after missing that last one.
I would say with the field goal now, that could cut it to a touchdown. So I know how kickers feel. They talk about that lonely world of the kicker, and you can certainly see that as Frank Johnson powers his way down, getting the football and trying to get first down yardage, but I'm not sure he's there, Delano.
No, I don't think he got it.
And a lot of people are saying they want him to go now. It's fourth down and what? He didn't get anything.
Coach Russell says, no, I'm
John
going
Gibson.
To kick it.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea. You're down here, let's get something. That's been the philosophy of the pros, and this would cut it to a touchdown. It would also help Tim Foley in getting his confidence back after missing that one a while ago.
That is, if he can make this field goal. If he misses, it will really hurt the drive, the momentum that Georgia Southern had picked up.
13 seconds and the clock ticking. Tim Foley waiting. Be a 32-yarder. That one's good. Folks, there is one touchdown different. It is 28-21 in favor of Maine over Georgia Southern. Maine so far has not scored in the second half. Four seconds left in the third quarter. Maine is yet to score in the second half. Georgia Southern has cut the lead to a touchdown, 28-21, on a 32-yard field goal by Tim Foley just moments ago, and Foley getting ready to kick it away once again. You've got Rob Sterling and Jim Fox deep to take the kickoff. 4 seconds to go in the third quarter. Georgia Southern trying to pull a little mirror image of Maine here and make the comeback. There it goes. This one's going to go deep. It's going to be taken by Fox at the 4. Fox back up near the 20-yard line. Cuts back across to the 25 and finally run out of bounds about the 28-yard line with several folks in hot pursuit, including Calvin Robinson.
They almost got Thomas Porter over there on the sideline. Thomas Porter, the starting rover back, who has been injured and out for the season. It was his senior year, and he was upset about it. But they almost got him over there on the sideline that time, almost rode him up.
That's the end of the third period with the score. University of Maine, 28. Georgia Southern, 21. We'll be back with the finale after this. The crowd in favor of Georgia Southern is on their feet trying to get the Southern defense to do it just one more time. That's become a battle cry around here that Irk Russell started when we made the playoffs a couple of years ago. He's saying, well, we've got the opportunity to play just one more time. Maine is suddenly, to their horror, seeing the momentum shift in Georgia Southern's favor, and they have scored now to close the gap to a touchdown, 28-21, thanks to a touchdown, extra point, two-point conversion, and a field goal. Back to pass is Mr. Buck. Complete. Finally, to Tony Lanza.
OJ.
Lanza is decked right away. I believe it was Oliver Davis had got him.
A warm reception he got that time.
He did indeed. 5-yard pickup. It's going to be second down and 5 for the University of Maine. The Black Bears trying to regain the momentum.
Fantastic fans on their feet.
Second down five. We're going to be going down to the sidelines here shortly with our Scott Pierce, who will be down there trying to a lot of the Georgia Southern players from last year here, and the give is going to go straight up the middle. Is that Fox? Can't even read the number, as many know. That's Wood. Ray Wood picked that one up, the big sophomore fullback, 5'10", 225 pounds out of Orono. 14 minutes to go in this ball game right now, 28-21. University of Maine, and we have got a barn burner, and the officials are stopping the clock for something or other. I guess they want to measure. Find out just exactly if whether or not we do have a first down. It's going to be second down or third down in a very short inch, as opposed to a very long inch, I guess.
Yes.
It is a first down, though, so we don't have to worry about it one way or the other. No need to get out the slide rule on that deal. First down for Maine as they get it up to about the 33-yard line. 32.
Danielle.
I take that back. It's the 37. First down, Maine. There in the eye. Buck back to pass. Wide open. Venditto. He's got it. And out of bounds. Nay Young comes over and gets him. And that's going to be a pickup of almost 6 yards on the play. Well, let's call it five. It'll be second down and five.
Maine is throwing some very short passes on first down and picking up about 6 or 7 yards, and it's giving them an easy chance for first down on second and third down.
You go with what the defense gives you, and if they keep you giving you those little 5 yarders, you can nickel and dime it right down the field and score the points, and it doesn't make any difference how you get them as long as you have them. Georgia Southern very close to being offsides on that play, and again, it's going to go up the middle, and it looks like first down yardage. For did Buck keep it himself? Yeah. Little quarterback sneak there. Very close to the first down, but there's a flag on the play as Bart Hughes makes the stop. Offsides, Georgia Southern. They didn't get back onside in time.
No, they didn't.
I don't think it's going to make a whole lot of difference. Well, I guess it's going to make a difference of about a yard or so, and it's going to give Maine an automatic first down, I would think. And we're going to go down to the sideline. Scott Pierce is standing by down there. Scott? How you doing?
Bill. Doing pretty good, Bill. We're down here with a pretty interested spectator. Donnie Allen played defensive guard last year for the Eagles. And Donnie, you have to think, we're backs are up against the wall. We've been in this position before, Furman 2 years ago. Fourth quarter, it's time to do it.
Yeah, I think we've got a lot of tradition on our side. The guys seem to be showing a lot of character right now. I think it's really crucial that we stop them right here and get the ball back, and maybe Raymond can generate some offense, and it's going to come down to the wire. I think what it's going to boil down to is who executes the best, and whoever does that going to end up winning the game. I hope it turns out in our favor.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Back to you, Bill.
Thank you, Scott. And Donnie Allen was a great one, was he not, Delano?
Yes, he was a smooth talker.
Yeah.
He was a smooth talker, too. Yes.
He is that. Maine has been involved in more overtime games than any other team in history. I believe they've been in four and won this season. Well, that 59-56 debacle there with clam bake that they had with Delaware or somebody.
They also have been in the longest ever football game. I think it was something like 4 hours they played for.
And there will be no tie today, folks, so we'll have to play this one in overtime, too, if it winds up tied at 28 or something along those lines. And there is the give. Is going to go straight up the middle to Wood, and Wood has just got yardage and yardage and yardage as he gets down to the Georgia Southern 40-yard line before Nay Young, along with Oliver Davis, can get him to stop. And you get a big guy like Wood going. It is hard to bring him down as you watch it again. Watch him just pop right through the middle there. Nay Young's just hanging on for dear life and said, please, somebody help me.
Well, you know it's bad news when defensive backs are bringing somebody down.
That's right, especially a guy of that size. 13 minutes to go in the game. 28-21. Maine in the lead and Maine driving. Buck rolling out. He's got Hebra. Hebra's got it. Goes out of bounds down there and is knocked down at about the 20, goes out of bounds at about the 22-3-yard line.
But they'll bring it back, I do believe.
And there's a flag. What are they going to call? Offensive pass interference?
I think it's going to be offensive holding. It's okay. In that area.
I never saw the flag. Where the heck did it go? He must have thrown it out of bounds.
No.
Back up here, the ball. Well, okay.
It's the right
flag's back
at
the 45. Well, no wonder I didn't see it.
When was the last time you had your eyes checked?
I'm not sure. It's been a few months, but I was looking over toward the receiver. Thought maybe they were calling an offensive pass
holding
interference.
On the offense,
big break
10
for
yards,
Southern.
Still first down.
Holding. First down and now 20. Ball right at midfield. Boy, this is when Buck shines. Let's see what he does here. Probably go back to Heber, wouldn't you think?
I would.
That's who he's looking for. He gets scrambled around, and he's going to get pulled down. He's got nowhere to go.
And that's the first sack of the day, I do believe.
Darren Alford is going to get him. Where in the world did Darren come from? We're glad to see him. At least Georgia Southern's glad to see him. Folks, I apologize to you up in Maine. If we've been following this program for 7 years now, and honest to goodness, we did try to get a Maine guy in the booth here to keep us in line.
But you did a good job of recovering that time. You caught yourself.
Mm-hmm. 12 minutes to go. Maine's in the lead, 28-21. No matter what happens, you folks, everybody can be proud of what's going on this field this afternoon. Dropping back into the shotgun formation, that's not good. Last time that happened, it was a disaster for Georgia Southern. Long pass going to go down. Nay Young is the only guy that can get to it, and he wouldn't have gotten it except out of bounds, and it's going to bring up a third down and about 25 or 6 yards to go, 24 yards to go. Third and a long way to go. Maine back in their own territory when it just looked like they were going to be driving again and looked like they had a first down at the 22-yard line of Georgia Southern. Boy, those penalties at that point can really be murder.
And I think it makes coaches lose the color of their hair. I think it makes it go gray.
That's true. Of course, Erk doesn't have to worry about that.
That's true.
He loves to kid about his baldness. There was a great article, if you read recently in Sports Illustrated, about him. As Buck from the shotgun goes back to pass again, the rush is on. Buck gets it away, and it's intercepted over there by Terry Young. And Terry Young is going to be down at about the 41-yard line. And back in the other direction as Terry picked this one off as Buck was rushed. And we are going to take a timeout for this. Georgia Southern has got the ball back with 11:29 to play in this ball game. As you watch it one more time just before we go to the break. 28-21 is the score. Watch Buck go back to pass. He's got his receiver open momentarily, but Terry Young is going to come right over here and pick it off right in front of him and run it back to the 41-yard line. 11:29 to go. Georgia Southern coming up to the line, and I don't believe the official is going to see the timeout signal. And so we're going to have to keep it right here. And Raymond Gross is going to pitch it out to Gary Miller on the corner. Miller turns upfield, gets about 4 or 5 yards, up to about the 45 or 46-yard line. Clock ticking with 11:18.
Well, I think the wide receiver, after that interception, made a very good play, because if he had not come back to tackle Terry Young, it may have been 7 points for Georgia Southern or 6 points for Georgia Southern, because they had a wall of blockers down the sideline.
Terry's fast. He and Nay Young are brothers. Both out of Savannah, right down the road here. 10:58 and the clock moving. And so is Gary Miller as he gets across the 50 inside Maine territory to about the 49-yard line.
Seeing a lot of Gary Miller here today.
We are indeed. Claude Petaway was the guy who made the stop. The ball just inside Maine territory. 10.5 minutes to go.
I think the goal line offense is in for Georgia Southern. They're going to try to pick up this 1 or 2 yards, probably on the ground.
Third and one. I would say, the infantry assault here. There's a big pileup, but I believe he's got the first down yardage. Let's see where they spot it. Right there in the middle of the eagle. They do such a good job working with this turf and this field. We talk about doing a program right, ladies and gentlemen. When they built Paulson Stadium, they put down the greatest turf in the world. First of all, it's God's stuff. It's not man-made. And secondly, we're on about 6 feet of sand as we see a player come limping off for Georgia Southern. Is that...
It's Ronald Warnock.
Ronald Warnock, we were talking about earlier. Big number 57 there, the tackle out of Eastman, Georgia. Limping over to the sidelines, and they bring it down, and let's see, is it going to be a first down? Yes. Just by the hair of their chinny chin chin.
Well, Jay Marshall was coming out the field even before they measured. He said they had a first down, so I guess we should have took his word for it.
Mm-hmm.
Why even measure?
I don't know. But I guess Maine probably said, let's take a look at it, too. Then we'll take that guy's word for it. 10:05, and the clock moving. Georgia Southern trying to tie this thing up. or at least get a little bit closer with a Tim Foley field goal as Raymond Gross finds the opening. He's over to the side to about the 35-yard line, pickup of about 15 yards on the play. Claude Petaway finally wraps him up. Ronald Warnock back on the field just there to come over and say, hey, nice going.
That's what you call a down-the-line option.
Boy, he can pick out those guys faster. Still, the way he carries that football is...
Scares you, doesn't it?
Amazing. Inside the 35, nose of the football resting on the hash mark of the 34-yard line just to the press box side of the field. This field is built, as we said, is put on... the grass is growing right in sand, about 6 feet of it. This, we could take like 12 inches of rain an hour, and still there would not be any water standing on this field. Now, Bill, Gary Miller gets a couple of yards.
Bill, I was here for the groundbreaking ceremonies of this this stadium, and there was nothing but a bunch of trees. And I said, you're going to put a stadium here?
Yeah.
No.
just trees and a field, and they built it down in sort of a natural bowl type into a valley so that they can double-deck it very easily. When you walk in, you're actually walking into the second deck the way you walk up to the stadium. It is very well conceived and constructed. They'll put up lights next season. The clock ticking just inside 10 minutes. Maine leading by 7, 28-21. Raymond Gross brings him up on second down. Gross cuts inside again to the 25. Gross to the 20. Gets away from a guy and gets down to the 15-yard line and is finally knocked down, and the ball is going to go out of bounds, but it rolls out of bounds just before the Maine player gets it. In hot pursuit, Rob Serling was over there to knock it away from him, and agonizingly, Troy Conquest had that football in his grasp, but not control. And the ball went out of bounds. We got another 3 yards on the fumble. Again, we talked about the way he carries that football. Of course, he tucked it away here just a little bit, switching it over to the other hand to take that hit from Sterling. And the ball goes rolling out of bounds. Another 3 yards up the field. Oh, boy.
Bill, now we know why Coach Russell has no hair.
Yeah, isn't that the truth? I'll tell you a story about that in a minute. And the give is going to be to Ross right there in the center as he gets inside the 10-yard line down to about the 8. But the story was told in the Sports Illustrated article about him recently that he came home from some meetings, and his wife said, we're going to a costume party. And he said, I'm too tired to go to a party besides I don't have a costume. She says, oh, you old coot, I'm going to put some perfume on your head, and you're going as a roll-on deodorant. She said, she told him one time, says, you love football more than you do me. He said, yeah, but I love you more than I do track. 8:11 to go. 28-21. Georgia Southern trying to tie it up. Ball at the 8-yard line of the Black Bears. A pitch out going to go over in the side, and we're going to lose some yardage to Frank Johnson, who gets whirled out of bounds over there by big number 46, and that is John Gibson.
Frankie Johnson was kind of holding that ball a little loose that time. I think it's hereditary in, the team.
A pitch over there, and boy, I'll tell you, Gibson was ready for that one, just hurls Johnson out of bounds. No place to go, a loss of about 3 or 4 yards on the play, so call it third down and 11, the ball resting at the 12-yard line.
I think for Georgia Southern to get a first down, they will have to score a touchdown.
And we're going to take a little pause here for just a moment with 8:01 to go, Maine leading 28-21. We'll be back. Southern trying desperately to tie this one up there at Maine's 12-yard line. They just lost about 3 yards on a last pitch out to Frank Johnson. 28-21. Raymond Gross is bringing him up on a big third down play. Could be one of the biggest plays of the day. In motion is Herman Barron to the right. Raymond's calling a long signal. I don't know if he's trying to get him to get out of, draw him off sides or what. He keeps looking, pitches it off, and it's going to be a touchdown as the pitch goes to Joe Ross. He was looking him off all the way.
But the referee says he was out of bounds.
Referee said he was out of bounds.
Well, no,
he
doesn't.
Argument? No, I think Sterling was trying to say he was out of bounds, and the official said no, he was not. As you're going to see the replay, and we'll find out the truth here. Here comes the pitch. It looks like he's down there at the 10. The pitch out goes, and I couldn't see it. I think he was close, but I don't believe he was out of bounds. Tim Foley is just about to tie this one up. 7:54 to go. Foley in to try the extra point. The All-American has got it up, and it is perfect. The score is tied.
Tie ball game.
Georgia Southern, 28. Maine, 28. And we'll be back after this. Back live from Paulson Stadium, Statesboro, Georgia, where Georgia Southern has come back and tied this ball game up. 28-28. Maine has yet to score in the second half.
Bill, I think we were trying to get something on the Ronald Warnock injury. We couldn't get there in time, but I think they've retaped his ankle, and he looks like he may be getting ready to come back in the ballgame.
That's good news for Georgia Southern. As Tim Foley gets set to kick it away. High, lofty kick. It's going to be backing up Sterling to about the four-yard line. He comes back across the 20, cuts up field, trying to get a couple of more, and not much. Back up to the 22-yard line. And the Georgia Southern defense coming out well rested. They have got to be fired up. Maine has suddenly seen the momentum shift. But this is a team, folks, that has scored 105 points in the fourth quarter. A lot of teams, especially the Falcons, would be happy with 105 points in a season, Delano.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah. Falcons would be happy with 5 points. But nevertheless, 28-28, 7:47 to play. Jeff Buck sets them down. They've got that back-to-the-wall mentality, according to Coach Tim Murphy. Let's see what happens here. The fake to Fox. Buck is being chased out of the pocket again. Buck is going to get out there and scramble for about 5 yards. It looks like it's going to be second down and five before Tim Brown, the defensive guard, a freshman out of Madison, Georgia, can bring him down. We're seeing a lot of young people in here, Delano, as Coach Russell trying to say, look, we got to give some of these guys a rest. We've got to go with some freshmen and just see what they do.
That's right. The freshmen have been producing, and both of these teams are young, and we may see these teams back in the playoffs next year.
7:13 to go. We're tied at 28. Second down and about five. As Buck is trying to rally the troops here. The give is going to go straight ahead to Fox. Fox breaks out for big yardage, getting close to midfield before he's finally hauled down by Oliver Davis. Pickup of about 20 yards on the play, somewhere along those lines. There for 5, 10, 15, about 20, breaking a tackle there. Taz Dixon had him for a second. And finally, Oliver Davis gets him at the 48-yard line. First down for Maine. 6:44 to play. Brand new ball game. Maine desperately trying to get something going here as Buck drops back to pass. Lots of time. Again, being chased out. Looking for somebody to throw to and then finally has to run. And it was very, very close. Flint Matthews came over to bump him out of bounds, and it looked like he might have bumped him just a second too late. He held up in time for the official. Had he really clobbered him, Delano, that would have been a 15-yarder.
Yes, it would have been.
6:27 to go.
Somebody up in the booth yelling no.
Yes, I don't know who that was. Play comes in from the sidelines. Jeff Knox bringing it in. Second down, seven. Ball rushing just inside Southern territory at the 48-yard line or the 49. In the eye, the give is going to go straight ahead to Doug Dorsey. Oliver Davis gets him. About a 3 or 4 yard pickup down to the 45. It'll be third down and five.
Will you talk about a big third down?
The board's got third down and five. That's nowhere close to five. That's about three.
They've changed
it now. Maybe even two and a half. Okay.
Jay Marshall for Georgia Southern getting the fans up, waving his hands.
Fans really getting into this one at long last. Almost 10,000 people here today, the largest playoff crowd ever at Paulson Stadium. And Georgia Southern darn near dropping off sides as the give goes straight up the middle to Wood, and Wood is going to have first down yardage, I do believe. To the 39, first down, Maine. This is their best-looking drive of the half, I do believe, Delano.
Well, we can say one thing. Neither one of these teams are a stranger to close ball games.
No,
having to come from behind.
Or to come back, that's right. Boy, Georgia Southern has just fought and clawed and everything else. A two-point conversion after a touchdown. They've scored two touchdowns, a two-point conversion, and kicked a field goal, and that has matched it up at 28.
Hate to see a loser in this ball game.
Isn't that the truth? 5:17 to go, and still lots of time to play. Remember that first quarter where we had 21 points scored as Buck drops back to pass. He's fired and wide open out there in the flats. Number 85, that's Tony Lanza, who gets it, and Oliver Davis knocks him down. Another first down for Maine at the 26-yard line of Georgia Southern. Clock stopped while they move the chains at 5:01 to play. 28 for everybody. The nose of the football on the hash mark this side, right on the 25-yard line of the Eagles. The Black Bears are coming back. Don't trust wounded bears. Buck is going to give it to Dorsey. Dorsey's going to get about 5 yards down to, I guess they're going to mark it, probably get stopped right about the 21-yard line. Pick up of about 4 on the play. Second down and 6. They're going to give him 5.
Well, I certainly feel sorry for someone who is not able to stand up in the stands because everyone else is standing and they can't see.
That's true. You're even standing here in the booth, huh? Kind of looking under this little rim on the window. Tony Lanza hurt on that play. They're taking him off. I hope he'll be all right. Scott Vendetto comes in the ball game. And let's see, Sarge Hebra is going over to, talk with Coach Murphy. He's coming out of the ball game for a sec. Get a little breather. I guess when you're a wide receiver, you do a lot of running, Delano. You go in those deep patterns, and that can take its toll on you quickly.
Woo boy, don't you know it.
Well, you're the one who knows. They're at the 20-yard line, second down and 5, 4:16 to go as the clock moves, 28-28. And Maine with their deepest penetration of the second half, trying to get something going here. The give is going to go to Dorsey. Dorsey's going to get the first down at about the 15-yard line, or at least very, very close to it.
I think he did pick that up.
He was over there to get it. Yeah, they're going to give it to him. Well, they're not going to. He earned it, of course. Just inside 4 minutes, 3:58 to go, and the clock moving now. 28 for everybody.
University of Maine breaking the huddle.
I want to ask you about the school colors for a second here, Delano, as soon as we get some time. But Maine, Buck has got him up to the line in the eye. The give is going to go to Dorsey again, and Dorsey's got no place to go as he gets wrapped up around the ankle there by big number 91 in there for Georgia Southern. That's Craig Walker, junior out of Roberta, Georgia, and I have no idea where that is.
Well, it's kind of ironic that the University of Maine comes into Georgia Southern with a strong passing attack, and virtually throughout this drive has been a great
on
running.
The ground. So it's going to be second down and about 10 yards to go. He might have gotten a foot or so on the play, but both teams have relatively the same colors. Can this be confusing to a quarterback at times when they're rolling out and kind of forget what uniform you're in?
Sometimes I think a lot of quarterbacks are confused just being confused on their own. Atlanta's quarterback, for one.
Well, that's true. Well, it's such an easy target. Let's not get the Falcons too much trouble as Buck is trying to get rushed out of the pocket here. Boy, they're going to knock him down. Oliver Davis in there leading the rush. Also, Craig Walker.
Coach Murphy's not going to like that. You don't want your quarterback to run backwards in that situation.
We're going to see it again, and you're going to see everybody in the world coming in on him. Craig Walker leading the charge. Tyrone Hull. Who else is in there? David Hodge. Oliver Davis. Robert Underwood comes off the field. Robert Underwood, this could be, of course, the last game that they play before the home crowd. Robert Underwood is a native of Statesboro, been playing before his hometown fans right from Statesboro High School right on through the entire Georgia Southern history. They played team ball, 2:08 to go. The score is tied. Folks, we go to overtime if it's still tied at the end of regulation. Buck is trying to change all that right now, of course. Straight back to pass. The long pass into the end zone to Serge Hebra. Knocked down by Nate Young at the last second on a beautiful defensive play, and Hebra's in agony over there. And I'm not sure if he wasn't even hurt on the play as he fell down and Nate fell on top of him. Hebra's getting up very slowly. Oh, gosh, I hope he's going to be all right.
Well, did you see how he got up?
Yeah, he got up
quickly.
He's
running fine now, so
yeah.
I think he's okay.
Tyrone Hull has been injured on the play. And see how they fell down? He kind of fell maybe on his hand or something, or his wrist.
Well, he seems to be all right. He's running over to the sideline right now. I think he may have been more disappointed that he didn't catch the ball on that play. Play by Nate Young.
It really was. And, of course, would never know with Hebra how soon he's going to recover and catch that thing just any second on you. Gosh, he's good. And we've got a timeout on the field as Steve Bell comes out here to try to punt it back to Georgia Southern, 28-28 with 1:52 to go. We'll be back. Everybody's standing at Paulson Stadium, except as Larry Munson said about a Georgia game one time. A few of them are upside down, but everybody else is trying to stand. And we got 1:52 to play in this one, and the score is tied at 28. Now, people, if it is still tied at the end of regulation, the ball is placed at the 25. They flip a coin, and somebody's got a chance to score. The old Kansas rule, sort of, as Steve Bell kicks one straight up in the air. And they're telling everybody to just get away and let it roll where it might. And it takes a nice main bounce to the 11-yard line. So 11-yard line, and Georgia Southern has the football with 1:41 to play and the score tied at 28. And we'll be back with the last part of this clam bake from Statesboro right after this.
Well, Delano and Bill, things are getting kind of antsy down here on the sideline. See the fans behind me really looking forward to a big drive on the behalf of Georgia Southern. A minute 41 left to go. The players are ready. The fans are ready. So it should be a good last drive. Back to you in the booth.
28-28 is the score. 1:41 to play, and Georgia Southern's on their 11-yard line. They're going to keep this one on the ground. Joe Ross is going to crack off of the right side, get across the 15 to about the 17-yard line. John Ballard gets him down, along with Claude Petaway.
Georgia Southern not going with their hurry-up offense. They actually had a short huddle.
A minute 20 to go, and the clock ticks away. The give is going to go. No, it's going to be a keeper by Raymond Gross. Gross gets out in the open field. He gets a block. Raymond Gross is at midfield. He could go. One more block is all he needs, and he's finally going to get run out of bounds by big number five over there, Keith James, who came over on the angle and ran Raymond out of bounds with 1:05 to go. We're going to see it one more time.
No penalty flags.
Raymond Gross, a nice fake. He finds the open field, cuts up against the grain, and it is now a foot race. Finally, Keith coming over.
Look at those wide receivers blocking downfield. And who is that running? That's a big offensive lineman running all the way down the field to throw a last block. It's amazing.
That is great downfield blocking and everything. And the people who don't get the credit, just because you're not carrying the football doesn't mean you got the play off. Ball is at the 31-yard line of Maine. The give is to Joe Ross. Ross cracks through a couple of folks, gets knocked down by a Maine player, and actually knocked forward about 5 yards down to the 25-yard line. 56 seconds. Scott Nason finally got him down. The ball is on the 25. 51 seconds to go. 50 seconds.
I think Georgia Southern is content with just running the ball right up the middle and taking their chances with the last second field goal.
I believe you're right, Delano.
You got the best in the country. You got to put all
40,
your marbles on them.
39 seconds. Raymond brings them up. It's second down and 4. The give is going to go to Ernest Thompson. Thompson tries the right side. He bounces off a couple of guys and finally gets maybe a yard. It'll be third down. 26 seconds. The clock continues to move. I would think Maine would want to stop it, wouldn't you?
I would. Well, not really.
Now Georgia Southern wants to stop it. Raymond Gross wants to go over to the sidelines and check things out with 15 seconds to play in regulation. We'll be back with the finale of this thing right after this. There you see the story, ladies and gentlemen. 15 seconds to go. 28-28. Georgia Southern on the Maine 23-yard line. Third down and 2. Time to run one more play, perhaps. The give is to Ernest Thompson. Thompson pulls his way for the first down to the 20, and Georgia Southern calls another timeout with 10 seconds to play. And a Maine player down on the field, I believe. Ernest Thompson getting up very slowly. I guess they were just sort of shaken up, along with number 26 for Maine. That's Claude Petaway.
I think Georgia Southern is going to run one more play and then call a timeout with like 2 or 3 seconds left to go. They got the first down.
Well, they decided, let's get Mr. Foley in there now.
Well, now they're bringing in the chains.
Tim comes in for what could be the biggest field goal of his life. There is no tomorrow for one of these teams, and it's just a shame that one of them has to lose. I know that's a worn-out cliche, but I can't think of anything else to say at this point, Delano. You folks in Maine have got to be so proud of these kids. 10 seconds to go. Tim Foley is lining up for a 32-yard field goal. He's made one today already.
I'm sure the University of Maine will call one more timeout, probably before he kicks it, to make him think about it a little while.
You know, I think, who was it, Western Kentucky or James Madison did that in and it backfired on him.
Yes, sometimes it works and sometimes
it doesn't. He said he wasn't really set that time, and so they called a timeout. So Maine says, all right, we'll take a timeout. We want Mr. Foley just to think about that about 60 more seconds or 120 more seconds, I guess it is. No, it's going to be a quick timeout.
We've got a bunch of...
No, the official says Maine's got a timeout. What are you trying to do? Okay.
We've got a lot of fans here looking mighty concerned. The mayor of Savannah is in the next booth to us, and he is, I think he's enjoying the game.
If you don't like this football game, you don't like football. That's all there is to it. Now, let's see. What we had mentioned earlier, riding on the line on this one was 20 pounds of Maine lobster that Dr. Dale Lick has bet against Dr. Nicholas Henry. And Dr. Henry, the new president of Georgia Southern College. And he has bet Dr. Lick, in turn, 20 pounds of Georgia ham. That's Georgia, J-A-W-J-A. There'll be a 37-yard field goal. Lady just turned around and looked up at the booth and put up a big sign that said the buck stops here. Well, the buck had stopped in the second half anyway, but boy, I'll tell you.
Well, the Maine University Black Bear fans say, no, it hasn't stopped here. We still have 10 seconds
left
to go in
this ballgame. Yeah, it's not etched in stone, of course, as we said, that Foley is going to make this thing. This will be a 37-yarder. And let's see, I think we haven't quite got all, at least from my monitor, we can't quite see the whole clock. It's not 1 second left, it's 10 seconds.
Well, if Georgia Southern were to make the field goal, would it leave about 3 or 4 seconds left for a kickoff? And with the way Maine has been returning kickoffs, who knows?
It's been scary, hasn't it? Here we go, sports fans. Maine wants to call probably another timeout. Or do they? I thought for a second they were going to call another one, so let him think about it some more. Let it get real cold.
I don't think you can call two timeouts back-to-back.
I thought you could. Well, maybe that's basketball. At any rate, Foley getting ready to kick this one. The longest 37-yarder of his life. This would break a 28-28 tie, put Georgia Southern in the lead for the first time this afternoon, and it's on the way. It is good. No. It went to the left, I guess. He had plenty of distance. It looked good from here. And there's 5 seconds to play. Foley can't believe it. He hooked it to the left. I thought that was through.
Well, we don't exactly have the best angle from up here, but it did look good from where we are standing. And Maine is elated.
Well, why shouldn't they be? 5 seconds to play, and I think they would be content at this point
to go to overtime.
To just run out the clock and go to overtime. They've played four of them before. They're going to extend their record of being in the most overtimes of any team in history with five today is the way it looks. And they've got the entire world surrounding Mike Buck. Buck is just going to go down on one knee, and this one's going to come to an end tied at 28. But playoff games can't end in ties. We go to overtime, and we'll keep it here. The way it works, as I understand it, it's not sudden death, is it, Delano? They put the ball at the 25-yard line, and there's a coin toss. Whoever wins the toss gets their chance of either taking the ball or kicking it or giving it to the other team. You've got a series to score.
It's a situation that many teams hate to be in, and I think this is the first time that Georgia Southern, since restarting football back in 1981, has been involved in an overtime game. So I think this favors the University of Maine because they have been in overtime games before.
And of course, by now, of course, all of your players have to be exhausted as well. So we're set to go to overtime. The ball will be placed at the 25-yard line, from what I understand it, and there's going to be a coin toss. They're moving the ball out right now to about the 30. Well, I don't know what they're doing.
Well, with the way Georgia Southern came out and played in the first half, I'm sure they're happy to be in an overtime game. It looked like they were on the verge of losing, and I'm sure the University of Maine welcomes an overtime after that last-second field goal.
That's true. Okay, Tim Foley couldn't put it through from 37 yards out. That was the second one that he had missed this afternoon, as a matter of fact. So it's talking over strategy on the sidelines. As you can see down there, Coach Irk Russell and his troops. And I'm sure Coach Tim Murphy's got a similar powwow going on across the field 50 yards away.
Coach Murphy, the youngest coach, as we've said before, in NCAA, whatever it may be. He's the youngest coach, and he's getting a few gray hairs today.
That's true.
He won't stay young for long.
Right. Now, there should be some representative from the NCAA here who could come in here and try to explain this screwy playoff system that they do have. From what I understand, if there's no score in the first period, we go to the second overtime period. And how much time do they put on the clock? I see nothing on there right now. What would you say, 5 minutes?
I think so. I think that's what they're going to put on there. I do remember Middle Tennessee playing in a playoff game, and they went into overtime, and I think they had three overtimes in that game. So.
It's the last thing we want today. Okay, the overtime period here is Appendix F of the NCAA rules. An overtime shall consist of a possession of the ball by both Team A and Team B. That would be a possession for each team.
Right.
Okay. If after both possessions there is no score, the score is tied, there will be a second overtime period. The scoring goes like this. The team scoring the greater number of points after an equal number of possessions shall be declared the winner, i.e., he who has the most points has won the football game. I'm glad we've got that straight. And the final score will be the total number of all points scored by each team during the regulation and overtime period. In other words, we don't start over again at 0-0.
Well, you certainly haven't brightened my knowledge of this.
Thank you so much. Well, it certainly enlightened mine as well. And we're having fun down here, aren't we? Statesboro, Georgia, folks, this is our first overtime that Georgia Southern's been involved in for Maine, number 5. And there's the coin toss in the middle of the field. Maine has won the toss, apparently.
No, I think Georgia Southern won.
Georgia Southern won the toss. How can you tell? I haven't seen any signal yet.
Well, Nae Young said, yes, woo.
Oh, all right.
In the middle of the field, so I think means that. But they'll be kicking off.
Okay, the ball will be placed at the 25-yard line from what I understand. Or will it?
It looks like it's going to be put at the 25-yard line.
So they will go down to the 25, and Maine will get the first crack at it.
Georgia Southern playing their theme song, one of the hits from the hit movie Dirty Dancing. So the fans are fired up.
All right, they put no time on the clock yet, so we don't know. I guess time isn't a factor. You have to play till somebody scores, so there's no time on the clock.
So the offense will get the ball and go in toward the goal line at the 25-yard line.
You get a series.
Isn't this just grand and dandy type way to settle this?
Yeah. Really special. So Georgia Southern blew a golden opportunity to win the ball game in the dying seconds. Maine gets a reprieve.
Mike Buck bringing the team up to the line.
Overtime we go. No time on the clock. You just run a series, and time is not a factor at this point. We have to have a score. Somebody from Maine moved, and Georgia Southern took advantage of the situation, and that'll cost them 5. So Maine will start from the 30-yard line, although one official is pointing to a Georgia Southern player.
False start on the white team. Ball will be on the 25.
From what I understand,
Billy,
would be a lot easier to just do it like the Hatfields and McCoys did. It just go shoot it out or something.
That's right.
Compared to what they're doing out here.
Well, you've got to break. There's no desirable way to break a tie. The way the Georgia High School Association does it is the craziest thing you've ever heard in your life. I won't even bother going to that. 28-28. We are in overtime. Maine starts from first and 15 at their 30-yard line. And the give is going to go up to Wood. Wood is cracks down to about the 20, picks up 10 yards on the play easily.
Got that 5 yards back for the penalty and more.
Didn't he, though? Wood looked impressive on that play. What made that work, Delano, was how quickly Buck got rid of that football. He looked like he was dropping back to pass. And, boy, Wood was right there at the line of scrimmage, took the handoff, and he was gone.
He certainly fooled me. I thought he still had the ball.
Buck brings it up again. It's going to be second down and 5. The give is going to go to Fox, and Fox is going to get a couple. Charlie Waller is there to meet him just as he gets across the line of scrimmage, and he picks up maybe a yard or so. It'll be third down.
Can you ask for more of an exciting finish than this?
Well, I don't think so. The amazing thing is that after all that, after 28 points in the first half and a team that has scored 105 points in the fourth quarter, the Georgia Southern defense came out and did the job they had to do. They have shut Maine out in the second half, the entire regulation period. It remains to be seen what is going to happen next. If you're not on the edge of your chair on this one, I think you're dead. Somebody give me a nitroglycerin tablet before a heart goes out here. And Buck is going to be hit and knocked down, and that is going to cause the pass to be a little bit short. It was intended over in the flats there for, who was that, Jeff? I couldn't make out who it was intended, either Dan Gordon, I believe. Dan Gordon out there in the flats.
Right. Georgia Southern came with an all-out blitz that time. Again, Coach Healy is sending everybody, everything except the kitchen sink.
So it's fourth down, and now Maine with their barefoot kicker. Peter Borestedt is going to try a 35-yard field goal. So Georgia Southern missed theirs. Let's see what Maine can do. Remember, Georgia Southern gets the football, and that one is good. No, it's off to the left as well. Well, I can't tell from our angle. And now it's Georgia Southern's fans' turn to go crazy.
Well, we know the field goal kickers won't have a good night tonight. They may be ostracized.
Georgia Southern gets another crack at it. Georgia Southern will start from the 25-yard line. That, according to our ace spotter up here, was partially blocked. I don't know who got their hand on it, and we don't have the replay. But thank goodness for Rob Witten. And the dive going in there, big dive across the middle.
Well, now, isn't the high school rule played on penetration?
Ernest Thompson hurtling in there. What Georgia High School Association does now, the private league does it a little differently.
Coach Russell is sending out Tim Foley on second down, I imagine.
All you have to do is kick the field goal.
And you win the ball game?
Yep.
Get out of here.
Yeah, since there's no time, it's whoever scores. So he's going to send Foley in there right now to kick. Maybe be a little further out. This is a 42-yarder, and Maine says, I'll call a timeout. Now, do the timeouts... I guess you still have your times out.
I think they give you two timeouts in the overtime period or something like that.
Sure they do.
Now, Tim Foley, you can see him stretching.
You can see Foley loosening up here.
Amazing.
And he's going to get a chance to redeem himself before the Georgia Southern fans. And remember, this is sudden death now if he scores, because Georgia Southern is now each team has had the ball. If he scores, this one's over, folks. Well, so once again, Tim Foley's got the destiny of the Georgia Southern Eagles in his hands.
I imagine if you're even required to run a play on that first down, because it's a wonder to me that Coach Russell didn't send Tim Foley out on first down. The kid, mm-hmm. He'll go as conservative as he is.
Who knows?
We're lost.
No, what Georgia High School Association does down here, and this is a wacky playoff system that we talk about, they play 2 5-minute periods. If the score is still tied, then they go to penetration. Crazy. Some high school kids play a 10-minute overtime, isn't it? So Foley will try one from 42 yards away. Remember, he missed a 37-yarder just moments ago. This one's up. It looks dead solid, perfect. This game's over. Georgia Southern wins 31-28, and the University of Maine absolutely stunned. Georgia Southern helmets just going all over the place. Tim Foley has redeemed himself. Once again, he's the toast of Statesboro. Georgia Southern on to play the winner of the Appalachian State-Richmond game next week. You folks in Maine, you have got to love these guys. They have played a fantastic ball game, and we just can't say enough about them. Gosh, I hate to see anybody lose this one. Everybody out there from Georgia Southern celebrating, and the Statesboro crowd going absolutely bananas. And we'll be back with a quick wrap-up right after we pause for this. Georgia Southern winning at 31-28. Greatest college football games or greatest football games that you will ever see. I know that you folks in Maine are just bitterly disappointed after a storybook season, but Georgia Southern going, advancing to the playoffs once again. Irk Russell is now, and the Georgia Southern Eagles are now 9-0 in postseason play, and Maine is right on the verge. You can see it. I can see them back here next year, Delano.
Well, the University of Maine has had a Cinderella season. They've had to come from behind so many times. I guess you can almost call them the cardiac kids. And my heart goes out to some of the players on their team, because they really came down here and gave their all. They had to play here in Georgia Southern away from their home. And they've come in and done a good job. And hate, like we said, we hate to see a loser.
Well, Southern was nice enough to bring some of the Maine weather here for them. But nevertheless, folks, we salute the Maine Black Bears. I know that you're extremely pleased with Coach Tim Murphy. It's been, I know it's a heartbreaking loss for you, and I expect to see you guys in the playoffs again. Look for four winning seasons in a row. That does it from Statesboro, Georgia. Thank you very much. For Delano Little, Bill Edwards, our director Fred Wagner, and all the staff associated with everybody in Lewis Broadcasting on this broadcast, good night and good afternoon from Statesboro, Georgia. See you next time.